Good morning, everybody. I'd like to welcome you to the DoubleTree Hotel and the 16th Annual Kern County Economic Summit. My name is Jeff Lamucci. It's my honor and privilege to serve as your Master of Ceremonies this morning. I'd like to thank Richard Chapman and everyone at the Kern Economic Development Corporation for the opportunity to be here. This really is one of the highlights of my year, and I hope it is for you as well. Before we begin today's program, I'd like you to please stand and join me as we individually and collectively reaffirm our allegiance to the United States of America by saluting the flag that represents our great country. Salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you very much. We appreciate your getting up early this morning and being with us. I trust you'll find it was worth the effort, as I'm confident the important information shared by this morning's speakers and panelists will be relevant, useful, and thought-provoking. As we get underway, I want to take an opportunity to thank the people who made today's event possible. The Kern County Economic Summit is an event co-hosted by the Kern Economic Development Corporation, California State University Bakersfield, and the Greater Bakersfield Chamber of Commerce. It's through the strength of their partnership and commitment to the community that the Kern County Economic Summit has grown to be known as the premier economic event in the Central Valley, and that's certainly evidenced by your attendance here today. We want to thank our many sponsors, including our platinum sponsor, Dignity Health, and our 11 gold sponsors, Pacific Gas and Electric Company, the County of Kern, Chevron, Valley Republic Bank, San Joaquin Community Hospital, and Kaiser Permanente, TBC Media, Bright House Networks Business Solutions, Bakersfield Association of Realtors, Tejon Ranch, State Farm, and Wells Fargo. Page 2 of your program contains a complete listing of sponsors, and let me just say, if you're not there, you could be and should be, and I'm sure one of our committee members would be glad to help you out in case you're interested in sponsorship. But for those of you who are on that list this year, we want to say thank you. This event would not be possible without your support, so would you all join me in thanking our wonderful list of sponsors. Whether this is your 16th visit to the Kern Economic Summit or your first, we're pleased to present you this morning with a day filled with outstanding speakers, noted economists, and business leaders who will provide you with valuable information concerning national and regional economic issues. And they will share how all of this influences the growth and future of Kern County. Today is a forum designed to explore ways we can sustain and advance economic prosperity in our growing region. Before I give our podium to our platinum sponsor, I'd like to call your attention to two things. First of all, if you would silence your cell phones and other electronic devices, we certainly do appreciate that, and we thank you for being considerate of others today. The second bit of housekeeping is regarding the insert you'll find at your setting underneath your program. It's the speaker evaluation form. We ask you to complete it because it's really important for our gathering, our organizing committee to gather information, and we honestly look at the evaluations. We use your feedback to plan the next year's event. So you can leave it at your place setting when you leave today or drop it off at the registration desk located outside the ballroom. So we appreciate your taking the time to do that. I'd like you to help me welcome to the podium Mr. Walter Ray, Vice President of Business Development for Dignity Health, Mercy Hospitals. This is the fourth year Dignity Health has taken part as our platinum level sponsor, and we're grateful for their continued support. So please welcome Mr. Walter Ray.
Good Good morning, everybody. Well, to start off, I am not one of those great economic speakers that we were just talking about earlier, so you'll have to suffer through me for a moment. And before you ask yourself, I do moisturize, so I look a lot younger than I really am. So thank you for bearing with me. My name is Walter Ray. I am the Vice President of Business Development for Mercy Hospitals, part of Dignity Health. And we are proud to once again support the Kern County Economic Summit and the efforts of this amazing staff in helping businesses in our county reach their full potential. The challenge in healthcare, because that's what I'm going to speak about because I'm in healthcare, but the challenge in healthcare is balance as we move towards especially this uncertain time in the 2016 presidential elections and what the outcome or future will hold. Here in Kern County, though, we are poised to meet the growing challenges of managing chronic health problems such as diabetes and heart disease, where we live with some of the highest numbers in the state of California. It's always fun to be at the top of a list, and that's us. As the largest hospital system on the West Coast, we know that with the passage of the Affordable Care Act, the government is favoring larger health care systems, which is the reason why you're seeing so many changes in the hospital landscape, as well as the healthcare landscape. Many standalone hospitals and small systems are finding it difficult to survive and are now looking to join larger healthcare systems. Dignity Health Corporation, which is based in San Francisco, is committed to the success of Bakersfield. They're quite fond of Bakersfield in the Central Valley. In just the past 2 years, we've expanded our footprint in this community, aligning with local healthcare businesses, including our recent partnership with the Grossman Burn Center, Comprehensive Blood and Cancer Center, the Millennium Surgery Center, U.S. Health Works, and Gem Care and Managed Care Systems. Dignity Health has also endorsed our plan to better serve the healthcare needs of the residents of Kern County. We continue to move forward on our construction of the new 120-bed tower at Mercy Southwest Hospital. That's a personal project of mine and very exciting as we move forward, so thank you for that. This tower and the related overall expansion to Southwest will enhance our tertiary services there, bringing an advanced level of technology complete with cardiac and neuro services for our growing neighborhoods in the Southwest and Northwest Bakersfield, as well as the outlying communities such as Shafter, Wasco, Taft, Button Willow, and Delano. And for those of you who grew up here in Bakersfield, you probably would never have guessed the west side growth as large as it is. Growing up on the east side, we never thought we would go that far out west, but that's where I live now. So this is more than just an announcement of a new construction project. This is an investment in economic growth in Kern County with the expansion of services and jobs and the advancements of our longstanding commitment that started over 100 years ago with our Sisters of Mercy that traveled up here to Bakersfield and has continued with Memorial Hospital and throughout the years. But it's a longstanding commitment to serve the residents of Bakersfield and of Kern County and to ensure that there's a quality state of health care with state-of-the-art care and services available to everyone here. The goal for all the hospital systems here in Bakersfield is try and keep us here. As much as we enjoy visiting Los Angeles, we would much rather receive our health care here, and we're getting very close to being able to keep you here for everything. So that's the goal that we all share, and we hope that you share that with us as well. I'd like to thank you all for being here today and hope you'll join us in continuing your support at the dedicated work of the Kern Economic Corporation, their Development Corporation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Walter, very much. We appreciate your comments and thank you once again for your sponsorship. I'd like to welcome Richard Chapman. He's the president and CEO of Kern Economic Development Corporation. When I saw Richard this morning, I walked up to him and went, and he said, "Do you have laryngitis?" I said, "I can't." Anyway, the look on his face was priceless. But I'd like to welcome Richard to the podium to introduce our first guest speaker. And Richard, thank you for all you do to help put this day on today. It's a great, great opportunity. And I, again, thank you for the opportunity to be here today. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Jeff, and I appreciate my limited time up here, I hope, and I'm sure you will as well today. And I would be remiss on behalf of myself and our organization if I didn't express our immense gratitude and appreciation for Ray Dezember. Ray was one of our co-founders. Thank you. Ray was one of our EDC's co-founders back in 1988, and I had the privilege of knowing him for my short time here, 9 years, and you know his optimism, humility, and vision for the community, I believe, were unparalleled, and definitely an icon, and definitely committed to moving forward and incorporating his vision. And it is a really a testament to his guidance that Kern County has succeeded and will succeed in the future. And it definitely should inspire us all. If you look at just another, you have a lot of handouts and bags, but happy to announce that our market overview, investor directory, the monochromatic version is on your table. So that was a great labor of love for our organization. Kudos to Fiona Lytle, who's no longer at our organization with Aera Energy. Thank you for being the architect, and thanks for our team working to create such a, I think, a masterpiece. And we'll be hard-pressed, but I'm confident next year will be as impressive as this edition. This will be online, kdc.com. So we have the hard copy, and let us know if you need also the PDF or what ISSU, I'm not sure all those iterations. The millennials get it, so hopefully you will appreciate that. And again, Kern County in all its glory, all its potential comes out in this document. Now I'm going to introduce, I know he's probably wondering when I'm going to mention his name, but Dr. Thornburg is going to be coming up to the stage shortly. We had the privilege of having dinner with him last night. He was more informally dressed, but that's a long story last night. Some of you will get that. His resume is very impressive. I will not read it all. He'll probably tell you about all his accomplishments. But his understanding of our economy moving forward, and I think it's appropriate. He is the founder of Beacon Economics, but also serves a director of Center for Forecasting at Riverside, UC Riverside. You'll be hearing later from Emilio Ramirez about the Riverside success story. And remember, in the context, we're the number two millennial job center in the country. Riverside's number one. So that's important to understand underlying all the information today, how well positioned we are for the future. And also, according to his resume, he was one of the predictors of the subprime mortgage collapse. I thought that was Christian Bale in The Big Short. And he looks a little taller, so maybe he had a cameo appearance. We'll let him tell you this. But he has a PhD. Chris has a PhD from UCLA and a BS from State University of New York in Buffalo. So go Bulls. Okay, go Roadrunners. Come on. How about the Roadrunners? Come on. See? You can tell I like applause, so I put that out there for you. But thank you for your time and commitment to this summit, and hopefully you have a great morning. We'll get you out before lunchtime. Thank you.
Dawns on me, I'm supposed to turn my microphone on here. Hang on, let me go ahead and get that done. Testing. Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you. It is great to be here. I have had the pleasure of being in Kern County plenty of times, but the first time working with Richard and the Kern County EDC, so I'm thrilled to be here. I am kind of, to set things off today, trying to give you some sense of what's going on out there in the world. By the way, I should point out something. Roadrunners, go Roadrunners, Bulls as well. By the way, Buffalo and Bakersfield both had the privilege of being in the NCAA tournament this year, and both teams had the privilege of getting wiped out in the first round. That's okay. We were there. That's the important thing. So, on to more important things. What is going on in the world? Now, if you have not been paying attention, let me kind of go through the litany. Market meltdowns, real estate bubbles, collapse of China, oil prices at, I don't know, 14 cents a barrel. Is that how much it goes right now? Honey, the kids aren't drinking milk anymore. It's too expensive. Feed them oil. I can go through everything, turn me, turn around. It is nothing but bad news, bad news, bad news. What is going on in the world today? Is the U.S. Critically in danger of no longer being great? That's what I'm going to try to give you a little bit of overview today. To start there, I'm going to start with a word. I love words. You know, economists are all about data, but I think words are more important than data because data without words is kind of meaningless, right? And every time I find a new word, especially one that is as relevant as this word is, I have to communicate that. So the word of the day, the word of this morning is miserabilism. Now, miserable, that's a real word. I picked this up, but I love this word. Miserabilism is the philosophy of pessimism, or if you will, trying really hard to convince everybody things are really bad when in fact they are not. And boy, are we in a bout of miserabilism right now. Now, there's nothing wrong with miserabilism. There are people who make a good living with miserabilism. Does anybody remember Morrissey? He was a miserabilist, right? Huh? And of course, a little more current, a little more, shall we say, modern generation. I remember Louis C.K., right? Of course, he's a miserabilist. And let's not forget, of course, the stock market's a miserabilist. They love miserabilism because bad news generates volatility, and volatility generates trades, which generate commissions, which generate profits. And of course, it is 2016, which means, of course, running across our great nation is this group of miserabilists, all trying to tell us that the only person who has the cure to our ills, of course, is them, if we put them in the White House. Now, of course, we should point out that the vast majority of these folks have now disappeared, but we are down to a pack of about six miserabilists at this particular point in time. How true is it? How bad are things? Look, first of all, take a step back. Forget all the noise about recessions and what's going to come next and all these big issues, and just look at the underlying facts. Look at what's actually happening out there. This is not bad. Things are fine, folks. Really, honestly, not great, but they're fine. 2015 was a good year. I know we ended up on a little bit of a soft note, but when you look at 2015 in the whole, turns out it was one of the better years we've had in quite a while. Labor markets continue to be nice and strong. There's no bubble. There's nothing close to a bubble right now. Housing still in recovery mode. Credit is starting to expand just a little bit, and that's good news for the economy. Commodity prices are down. I realize cheap oil isn't necessarily good for West Kern County, but overall for the U.S. economy, cheap oil is a good thing, not a bad thing. Simple as that. And guess what? California, remember we were written off? The next Greece, the next Detroit, failing in a puddle of anti-business climate. Well, look, I realize California is a difficult place to work in, but on the other side of it, I also know something, that California has been a success story for a long time, and guess right now, we are, again, a success story. In fact, right now, California is driving the nation forward. We are one of the strongest components of growth in the U.S. right now. Now, none of this means things are fine. I mean, I get it. There's all sorts of issues. We're still growing a little slower than we might want. State and local budgets are still stressed, too much money going to the wrong things. The global economy is wobbly, particularly China. We're dealing with bad financial regulations, local housing shortages, pensions, entitlements, inequality, political gridlock. I get all that. But here's the key. None of these things can cause a recession. None of these things are going to influence the path of the economy over the next year, the next couple of years. If you want to know what the base forecast is, and, you know, as a forecaster, I'm pretty good at understanding how forecasting works. Here's the reality of the situation. You got 2 years out of me, okay? 2 years. That's what we can really see, 2 years. And we have 2 years of growth in front of us, no doubt about it. The chance of a recession in the next 2 years is functionally zero. Not going to happen. But that doesn't mean the business, if you will, of business is done, and quite the opposite. We need to focus our attention on these midterm challenges. And that's what bothers me most about all the miserableism going on in our economy today. We are so busy, wrapped up in the nonsense of what is not or not happening in our economy right now, to pay attention to those true midterm challenges. So my goal today, in the context of the 40 minutes I have with you, is to try and give you some sense of A, why I'm so optimistic about the next couple years, but then B, try to divert your attention a little bit towards the issues that do really challenge us, things we should be focusing our attention on. So let's just start with the big picture, GDP. Last year we grew at about 2.4%. Not, you know, a little below average. We grow between 3 and 3.5% on an average year overall. So a little less than normal, but still moving forward at a pretty good basis. Scratch away at the surface. That number actually doesn't give you a good read in the economy. I want to look at actually the demand coming, growth in demand inside the U.S. economy. We call that final demand. That is a growth in spending by governments, businesses, and consumers. That actually grew about 2.9% last year. That's the best year since the Great Recession came to an end. It was a good year. The overall GDP number was a little lower, mainly because of two parts of the economy. One was trade. We did see a widening of the trade deficit last year, but not for the reasons you think. And two, of course, was a pullback in non-residential construction. That, of course, was drilling new oil wells having to do with the cheap oil. But otherwise, every part of the U.S. economy is really ticking along. Take consumers, for example. You might have heard that towards the end of last year, the retail sales were weak. It was a terrible Christmas season. Retail sales growing 1% on a year-on-year basis. That number doesn't mean anything. It's a nominal number. It's not price-adjusted. If you haven't been paying attention, this is an extremely low-inflation world we live in right now. In fact, if you look at data coming from the Bureau of Economic Analysis on spending on goods in real terms, turns out American spending on goods over the course of last year grew close to 4% on a year-on-year basis through the entire year. Americans are buying tons of junk. Tons of it. And by the way, that junk's pretty cheap. We're all happy. And keep hearing this term. Oh, where's the gasoline dividend? Where's the gasoline dividend? Gasoline's so cheap. Why aren't people spending it? They are. Look at auto sales. Auto sales through the roof last year. One of the best years ever for auto sales. The best year ever for American auto manufacturers. Never have American auto manufacturers sold so many cars. The funny thing about oil is we continue to have this sort of 1970s mentality that when the price of gas goes down, people have lots of money and they spend lots of things. And when it goes up again, they can't spend anything. It's actually gasoline expenditures are a much smaller part of our budget than they were back then. And of course, today we have options. We have ability to change our world, if you will, just a little bit. You want to know what the gasoline dividend is? Here's the gasoline dividend. The gasoline dividend is when you get to go out to your garage and look at that Prius and go, I always hated driving that car. That car sucks. I'm driving the Hummer today. Woo! That's the gasoline dividend. And that's what people are doing. They're buying big cars again. They love it. Everything's happy on that particular front. There was a little bit of slowdown in service spending, but that's mainly utilities having to do with a warm winter. But otherwise, things are fine. Labor markets continue to be strong, adding about close to 250,000 jobs a month, 2.6 million jobs over the course of last year, about 2% growth overall. One sector got hit, mining, about 135,000 jobs. But mining isn't that big a part of the U.S. labor market. It's not even a big part of the Kern County labor market, as the case may be. So a big negative there, but other parts of the economy moving forward very nicely, not the least of which is construction, which added 260,000 jobs, twice as much as what mining lost over the course of last year. So lots of good things happening there. Unemployment rates continue to fall. I love this. I always love this debate. The right unemployment rate, the wrong unemployment rate. The bottom number there is the U3. That's the one that's 4.9%. It's the headline unemployment rate. And as soon as you bring up that number, there is always going to be somebody else going, well, that's not the right number. The right number is the one that includes workers who are discouraged or who are underemployed. And that would be the top number, the U6, as we call it. And I love this debate, which is right, which is wrong. Well, the answer, which is right, which is wrong, depends on who's in the White House. If there's a Democrat in the White House and you're a Republican, the top number's right, right? And if there's a Republican in the White House, a Democrat, you see what I'm saying? Look, neither one of these numbers is right or wrong. They're just two ways of measuring the same thing. And here's the key point. They're both falling. And by the way, the U6 and the U3 have both fallen to the point that right now that you're seeing enough compression in the labor market that real wage is starting to go up. This is good news. This is good news. What about the participation rate? Very weak right now. Well, it is true. The participation rate has fallen a lot. But guess what? That's not because of the Great Recession. It's not because of the weak U.S. economy. It's because the boomers. Now, look, I know the conversation today is about millennials. And millennials, of course, are an interesting generation. I hire a pack of millennials. I know this because they either quit or went by text messaging me. As far as I know, they're not capable of looking me in the eye. And for the most part, if I don't compliment them on their work every 15 minutes, I'm in big trouble. I'm a terrible boss. But putting all that to one side, the big change in our economy today really isn't millennials. The millennial generation is big, but they're really only a little bit bigger than my poor generation. By the way, I'm a Gen Xer. And if I sound a little bitter about millennials, it's because as an Xer, by definition, I'm bitter about everything. But who wouldn't be? Who wouldn't be? We are caught between the boomers and the millennials, which are two groups of the most spoiled people on the planet, as far as I can tell, leaving us poor Xers in the middle having to pick up the mess. But anyway, Xers, go. Raise your hand if you're an Xer. Power. Power, sisters and brothers. We will persevere. Anyway, look, the biggest change in the population base today is the 16 to 24-year-olds grew 4% over the last 10 years. 25 to 54 didn't grow at all. That population base fed. The biggest increase is the 55-plus range. It grew 30%. It's all the millennials moving into those later years of the workforce. That's when participation rates naturally fall. 3/4 of this participation rate decline would have occurred even if we had never had a Great Recession. There's no doubt there are some people on the outside still looking in. But for the most part, the labor markets really have mostly healed at this point in time. And really, this is a U.S. economy that's strong, that's doing well. How about consumer credit? That's been expanding very nicely right now, growing about $20 billion per month. Overall outstanding consumer debt has just gotten above $12 trillion again. One of the big questions is, this is good news or bad news? After all, since you did see The Big Short, you all know that consumer borrowing got us into the big problems last time. Well, yes and no. Look, it is true that Americans hold a lot more debt down than they did 15 years ago or 20 years ago, but then again, remember, the cost of that debt is much cheaper now because of low interest rates. Indeed, if you look at the financial obligation ratio, the percent of household income used to support current financial obligations, it never really got that high last time, and right now it's the lowest it's ever been. Never has debt been less of a burden on American households than right now. The big issue to that last cycle had to do with the quality of debt. Subprime credit card loans, subprime auto loans, of course, worst of all, the subprime mortgage loans. It was the quality of debt that blew up and created the massive financial chaos in our system, not the quantity of it. And by the way, right now, quality is still too good. The markets are too tight. If you look at, for example, the credit score by origination for mortgage loans right now, the median credit score is above 750. 20 years ago, it was 700. This is a problem. In fact, if I said, what's with consumer debt in our economy today, I would say it's still a problem, because there are still a lot of people being locked out of the housing market, which is one of the reasons why the housing market recovery is slow. Now, this, of course, is the law of unintended consequences. This all stems from back in the day when Liz Warren got up there. And by the way, people always ask me my politics. I am a radical centrist, okay? That means when anybody running for president starts talking, I close my eyes and go, la, 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 I don't want to hear. Because it's a disaster. But again, you know, I just love these financial regulations we have, right? Dodd-Frank. Well, Dodd-Frank is based on this idea: banks bad, borrowers good. Banks evil, borrowers innocent victims. No, it doesn't work like that. Look, there was a breakdown in credit standards. Everybody on both sides of that transaction was to blame, and we have to prevent that from happening again. Fine, but you don't set up a system that functionally locks these people out of the credit market, which is exactly what Dodd-Frank has done. There were a group of Americans got absolutely hammered through this last downturn. They should have had the opportunity to get back in the housing market at this time of historic affordability, and instead they have been locked out. And that is a big problem for our economy. We need to revisit that equation, because there are ways of having this conversation that doesn't boil down to bad and good. There's a much more nuanced central version to that particular conversation. Indeed, if you look across different types of consumer debt, right now every type of consumer debt is seeing lower and lower delinquency rates with one exception, student loans. Student loan delinquencies are up. Ah, the student loan crisis. You probably heard this on the election trail. The horrible burden our millennials are carrying today because of the extensive student loan debt that these poor kids are carrying with them. I have never in my life heard such a pile of garbage as the student loan crisis, okay? First of all, right off the bat, who knows this number? What is the average student graduating from college today have in the way of student debt? What's the average student have? Anyone? 37, I heard. Someone else? 60, I heard. How much? 35. No, you're all wrong. It's $24,000. You might have heard the 35, but here's a little star asterisk after that. It says average $35,000 for the students that graduate with debt, because a lot don't. And once you add that into account, it's about $24,000. Folks, that is not a life-altering event. $24,000 of debt is a mid-range Kia, okay? Can we please be rational about this conversation? And by the way, take a step back. Where is the largest amount of, where's the biggest problem with delinquencies with student loans? For the student with 150K or the student with 5K? Turns out it's 5K, not 150K. And of course, the person with 150K probably has a medical degree, and they're probably starting at $185,000 a year with Kaiser. The person with five was probably some poor person who got suckered into one of these fly-by-night for-profit colleges. That's not a student loan crisis. That's fraud. The debt should be forgiven. The person who made that loan should go to jail, and we should close the school down. But putting that to one side, there is no student loan crisis. Well, is college degree still worth it today? I see that on the internet all the time. Maybe I should stop looking at the internet. This could be part of my problem. Of course a college degree is worth it. Look, the net present value of getting a bachelor degree today is $300,000. That's net of taxes paid, that's net of college tuition paid, all the above, $300,000. That is still the best investment you will make. And what's most amazing about that number is it's that high despite the terrible educational choices our children are making. And that's the big key thing. You know, look, back when I went to school all those years ago, to some extent, you get a degree, you'll be fine. Because back then it was still, you know, something new. It was a kind of a thing you held up. Today, everybody goes to college. Not everybody, but a lot of people do. And as a result, that just having a piece of paper is no longer, if you will, the ticket to a good, you have to look at a college education like an investment, like any other investment. And unfortunately, we don't have that conversation with our kids. We have some great data now. American Community Survey, we can actually go through the data and figure out what kind of degrees people are getting. And this is degrees people are getting ranked by income. And this is for 21 to 27-year-olds. And it turns out the highest value degrees from a wage perspective for full-time workers is engineering, 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 computer science, engineering, 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 mathematics. You working with me here? In other words, it's all the degrees that don't allow you to necessarily party every single Saturday, Friday, Thursday, Wednesday, and sometimes Tuesday night, okay? Well, that's nice. I get that. These are harder degrees. Because they're worth so much, clearly many people are getting these degrees, right? No, not at all. In fact, the number one degree awarded in the U.S. over the last 5 years is psychology. 300,000 degrees in psychology awarded in the last 5 years in the U.S., 60,000 per year. Folks, Americans are messed up, but really? 60,000 psychologists per year? I don't think so. This is the conversation, not that there's a student loan crisis, but look, I'm not saying don't chase your dreams, but if you want to chase your dreams, may I suggest starting in a community college and then going to a state school? If, on the other hand, you're going to Stanford, you're going to get an engineering degree so you can afford it. That's not a difficult conversation. That's called a rational conversation. That's the kind of conversation we need to have. All right, I'm behind. How about housing? Housing is doing fine. Not great, but fine. 5.5 million sales. Home prices continue to grow at about 5% on a year-on-year basis. I look at the big change in growth, mainly the West Coast and the South at this particular point in time. Have homes gone up too high in terms of prices? Not at all. If you look at housing affordability controlling for 4% mortgage rates, turns out houses are still affordable to a record degree. Yes, affordability has declined, but only from record high levels of affordability. This is a market that still has a lot of legs in front of it. If you look at housing starts still weak. We should be running about 1.2 million new single family housing starts. We're still 100,000. Again, this goes back to the issues with mortgage origination. When you lock a huge part of the population out of buying a home, it turns out they don't buy homes. We don't build a lot of them. Now, things are changing. It's become a little easier to borrow out there. And that will start to help move our economy forward over the course of the next couple of years. This is a positive thing. Yes, it's frustrating the housing market hasn't recovered as much, but because it's been such a slow recovery, think of the legs it's going to have on a tortoise versus hare kind of argument. And of course, there's better news. On the left, this is one of my favorite graphs out here. On the left-hand side is change in households. And this tells such a perfect story for what's been happening in our economy. You can see the huge surge in the middle part of last decade. That's when your 23-year-old announced they had just gotten their first subprime loan, and were buying their first house, and were going to become the next real estate millionaire. Okay? 2 years later, when that household formation number collapses, that's when your now 25-year-old has moved back into your basement because they got foreclosed on. Are you working with me here? Just now, household formations are picking up. People are starting to move out again. And as a result of that, more demand for homes, less vacancies. It's going to be a good year for housing. That's important for the U.S. economy. It's going to keep us moving along. How about industrial production? You probably heard a lot of bad things about manufacturing. Turns out manufacturing's not doing bad. Oh, it hasn't been growing very rapidly, but it is still growing. Manufacturing output is up, not down. I don't care what the ISM index says. That is a survey. It is not an actual number the way the production numbers are. Well, how can that be? How can it be up? Well, you got to remember, there are parts of the industrial production are doing bad, and there are parts that are doing great. Great is motor vehicles, electric machinery, non-metallic minerals, petroleum refining, furniture. All these are up. What's down is two sectors, mining and non-metallic minerals. That, of course, has to do with the commodity bust going down. In particular, the big crunch has been with mining of new wells. What's going on out there? Why is oil so cheap? Well, look, this is not a demand phenomenon. I can't tell you how many times I've heard this sort of throwaway line in the news. Oil is so cheap because of China. Really? China? First of all, folks, I know China's slow, but they haven't stopped growing. They're still growing. By the way, for anybody who's wondering, in 2015, the Chinese imported 9% more oil than they did in 2014. Cheap oil is not a Chinese phenomenon, period. This is not a demand issue. Oil is cheap not because of demand. Oil is cheap because of supply. What kind of a supply? American supply. Look, 5-6 years ago, U.S. production exploded, and we went from a little over 5 million barrels a day to almost 10 million barrels a day. Why? Because of fracking. To put this in context, right now the U.S. is producing more oil than any other country in the world. We're producing 15% more oil annually than Saudi Arabia is. People keep saying, why isn't Saudi Arabia trying to drive prices up? Because they're no longer the swing producer. We are. And by the way, we've had cheap oil for over a year. Why hasn't production fallen? Because they got so far ahead of themselves in terms of fracking that there were over 2,000 drilled unfracked wells when oil prices started to fall. And every time oil prices go up just a little bit, they uncap a well, crack it, pull the oil out. And this isn't going to slow down at all. Look, fracking is a brand new technology. We have years and years of supply of oil sitting in the ground in shale oil reserves. And we're not the only ones. The Russians have huge oil reserves. Brazil, Argentina, China, everybody has these huge shale oil reserves. This is a brave new world. It's a brave new world, and that means oil is gonna be cheap for a while. Now I realize that's tough on Kern County. By the way, you inventing fracking, this is your fault. The Russians and the Saudi Arabians will be filing a lawsuit against you any time now. Be prepared. But, it's a brave new world. Simple as that. And by the way, on net, yes, this is good for the U.S. economy, period. It's good for consumers. It's good for the farmers. It's good for the logistics companies. It's fine. Yes, there's some shakeout, but it's not going to sink the U.S. economy. Not even close. Look, we've seen this play out before. In the mid-80s, in the late 90s, two periods of time, we see big pullbacks in mining in U.S. economy, and it didn't influence anything. Nothing else happened because it's relatively constrained. And this time, it's even better. Because right now, while we are getting hit in terms of overall decline in mining activity, we're still producing lots. And that's driving other parts of the economy, as the case may be. Indeed, here's some numbers. This is employment indexes for various sorts of parts of the United States. North Dakota's way down. You can see they peaked, and they've come down pretty sharp. I mean, that's that big decline there, and it's got to be at least 114 jobs. At least 114 jobs in North Dakota, right? But then you go to the next number down. That's Houston, center of course, the shale in southeast Texas. And you can see that haven't even stopped growing. I mean, they've slowed down, but they haven't shrunk. It's not 1985 where they had one of the worst regional recessions ever. Dallas hasn't slowed at all. People were wondering, will oil sink the U.S. economy? It hasn't even sunk the Dallas economy. So, yes, we're in a transition. There's some companies that are struggling, but for the most part, it's not a big enough challenge to threaten the U.S. recovery, as the case may be. The other part of it's trade. Again, well, the dollar's high, China's not doing too well, that's why U.S. can't export products. Again, completely not true. The real exports, once you price adjust, real exports have been nice and steady for the last year and a half. They haven't fallen. They haven't been growing, but they haven't fallen. U.S. manufacturers, because of efficiency gains, because of competitiveness, continue to thrive in the global economy despite the fact that the dollar is up 15% and the global economy is wobbly. The reason the trade deficit is widening is because of imports. It's because Americans have lots of money, and they're spending it, and they're spending on stuff made in China. That's what's driving the trade numbers. So we're okay, a little bit of a stall, but there's nothing here that worries me. Nothing is going to slow down our expansion, as the case may be. And what about the bubble? What about the financial bubble? There's no bubble, not even close to a bubble. Yes, I know, I've heard all the worries about tech and worries about unicorns and worries about the stock market and worries about subprime. Forget it. Look, four reasons why there's no bubble, nothing you have to worry about. Asset prices have gone up a lot, but asset prices have gone up because of low interest rates. Go back to your finance class. You know, one thing you remember from finance class, your finance professor would say, okay, you have an asset and it gives you $100 every period forever. Interest rate's 5%, what's that asset worth? And you go, I remember this formula. You take your 100, you put it under 0.05, $2,000. Ding, ding, right answer. What if the interest rate falls to 3%? Well, now it's 100 over 0.03. That means, of course, it goes up to $3,000. Or $3,300, something like that. Anyway, you get the right idea, right? That's the key here. We're seeing asset prices go up because we are in a low interest rate regime. Ah, but interest rates are going to go up any day now, right? No. Look, interest rates have been falling for 25 years. They've been falling because inflation has gone away and because we live in a world that is awash with capital. This is a world, back before the Great Recession ever became a thing, Ben Bernanke, when he first got in office as the new head of the Federal Reserve, talked. His first speech was about what he called the global savings glut. The fact that we have far more supply of capital, boomers trying to catch up with retirement, pension funds trying to catch up, China, whose economy is almost as large as the United States, who has a savings rate 2.5 times our savings rate, pouring capital into global markets. Lots of supply, not as much demand. That's a low interest rate regime. That's exactly where we are. So these asset prices make sense in that metric. Now, by the way, there's another reason to think about it as well. Here's the key. Every time the stock market goes through one of these conniptions, I want you to remember this. Asset markets don't create recessions. Oh, Wall Street will tell you they do. You hear it all the time. Oh, worry about wealth effects. The financial markets worry about this, worry about that. The famous old joke, Paul Samuelson had said this was, the stock market has predicted 9 of the last 5 downturns, okay? That's because every once in a while, the market periodically freaks out. But unless the real economy is out of whack, unless there's real imbalances, for example, 2006, households weren't saving. 2006, we are building 2 million homes for a nation adding 1 million households. All sorts of big problems you could see out there. Where are the problems today? If there's not problems in the real economy, it doesn't matter what the financial markets do. Always keep that in mind. So where are we on that particular front? We'll take the stock market. Yes, stock market was near an all-time high. Guess what? So are corporate profits. They've grown faster than any other part of the economy. If you look at a forward-looking P/E ratio, looks like asset prices look just fine. Indeed, if you do an equity earnings spread, take that P/E ratio, flip it over EP minus a 10-year treasury, even before the sell-off, stocks look like a still good buy. And of course, Business America, their financials look good. Not only is profits, but their debt to equity ratios are nice and tight right now. No problems here. And of course, as for the market itself, you can't possibly understand what this says, but let me explain it to you. Typically, we have one market sell-off in a recession and then one non-market sell-off in a non-recession period. When I say a market sell-off, I'm talking about like a double-digit decline in the market. Since the Great Recession came to an end, we've had 4 double-digit meltdowns in the stock market, and all 4 have gone away with nothing happening. Look, the stock market isn't telling you what the economy is doing. The stock market is behaving like a room full of first graders drinking espresso and playing full contact musical chairs. There's a lot of noise, a lot of action, and not a lot of logic. So your best bet is to ignore it. Forget the market. It's irrelevant. Just forget it, okay? And as for interest rates, they're going to stay low for a while, and I just told you, the global savings glut. How about California? Again, a few years ago, this is a quote. I had to respond to this. I was in San Diego for a bond buyers conference. And this was the question they put in giant, 117 font on the screen in front of me. Looking back a few years, 2009-10, everyone was saying California's going to fail like Greece. Detroit, things look different now. What has happened to turn things around? Well, the first thing I said was, not everyone said that. That's a preposterous thing to say. It's a stupid thing to say. Look, I get it. Are we a business-friendly state? No. No, we are not a business-friendly state. I get that. But guess what? Doesn't matter that much. See, that's the dirty little secret. Oh, everybody's constantly talking about Texas. Oh, they're so business-friendly. Kansas is very business-friendly right now. Their economy is imploding. By the way, California, their business and friendliness is not a new phenomenon. I've been here 25 years. It's never been a business-friendly place from what I remember. And it hasn't mattered. California continues to be a success story. Now, it isn't to say we shouldn't be in Sacramento fighting like the Dickens to make this place a little more business friendly, but not because it's for growth. It's for us. It's to help us keep our sanity. That's why you need to be up there and fight that fight. But don't think that this is a growth issue, because it really isn't. Not the way that people try to sell it to you. And look at the numbers. In 2014, California, one of the fastest growing states in terms of output, Texas as well. How much of Texas is oil? How much of Texas is Rick Perry's genius? Well, let's fast forward to 2015, and now Texas is not growing at all from an output perspective. Sorry, Rick. California, of course, still moving along just fine. Over the last 20 years, we've 30% growth in our payroll compared to 20% overall. We're in the top 6 or 7 for growth in the nation right now. All good numbers, as the case may be. What kind of jobs? What kind of output? Construction, top of the list, logistics, information, healthcare, hospitality, education, professional, everything growing, good solid numbers. The only thing doing weak in the economy right now is a total farm only up 0.3%. I'll come back to that in just a second. Services up about 1.4%. Financial activity is up 1.5%. Government 1.6%. But a lot of important sectors doing very well. As for output growth from the third quarter 14, third quarter 15, most recent numbers there, we're kind of showing it up. Our economy grew 3.5% over those four quarters compared to, that's about 1.4% higher than the state nation overall. And I go through the list of rapidly growing parts of our economy, hospitality, management, wholesale trade, construction, professional, and top of the list, one of the most rapidly growing parts of our economy right now is agriculture. Through the roof, from an output perspective, as well as from a revenue perspective. Now this may be a bit of a shock. You probably have heard about our drought. What is going on in agriculture? Well, look, I realize this is an ag community, and I realize this is a sensitive subject, but folks, we need to talk just a little, okay? Last year, when Jerry Brown said, hey, you urban areas gotta suck it up, I was a little surprised, because his point of saying, well, all the urban areas have to have a 25% cutback, but the ag areas don't, is because the ag areas have been suffering. They haven't. Ag employment's at an all-time high. Ag income's at an all-time high. In 2014, the most recent complete data, revenues, middle of a recession, ag had grown their revenues by 5% over the previous year. Ag's doing great. Ag's doing great. So let's stop pretending for a second that they're not. They are. They're doing fine. And I don't begrudge anybody in the ag community doing well. I'm happy the numbers are up. I'm happy things are looking good. Here's my problem. My problem is how the ag community is making money. Specifically, let me kind of go into this. The most recent crop reports suggest that in 2014, we had about 1.3 million acres of hay growing in the state of California. Hay, an incredibly water-intensive, low-value crop. We're talking a crop that per acre uses about 5.5 acre-feet per year. In other words, all the hay grown in the state of California in 2014 adds up to about 65 to 70% of all urban consumption. Now again, hay's cheap. It's $200 an acre foot. That's what you get for it. That up to be clear, that means all the ag production in the state, all the ag production in the state is about 2% of ag revenues. This is a low value, water intensive crop. If we just halved the production of hay in our state, we would have plenty of water for all the other needs, for all the other farmers, for all the nut guys out there, and for the urban areas. We could refill our reservoirs. And ag revenues would have still gone up, because that tiny little share of ag revenues is less than the growth in revenues from 2013 to 2014. We gotta be serious about this. And by the way, I'm not telling the ag guys, I wanna take your water away. Not at all. I want to pay you for your water. Because guess what? A hay guy, he's making 50 bucks an acre foot he's using. San Diego, they're willing to pay $2,000 to desalinate. I see a transaction here, folks. How about you pay them $100 for that water? Oh, I got an idea. There's so much value left over, we'll put $100 in to restore that land for environmental or recreational use. And I'll throw another $100 in to develop a fund for economic development in those ag communities. The only people who suffer from this particular transaction are Chinese cows and pigs, because that's where a quarter of that hay is going. It's been put on boats and shipped to China. This is so obvious. This is so good for every part of California to have this conversation. Why don't we? Why isn't it happening? Why can't San Diego pay that hay guy in Imperial County for that water? Because we have 1,300 water districts. That's why. The water districts control the water, but they don't profit if they sell it. Their job is to take the water and give it to the people they've always given it to take usage and separate it from ownership is insane. That's not how you manage a scarce resource. So let's take a deep breath, take a step back from the ledge here, and recognize a little bit of logic applied to the allocation of one of the scarcest resources our state has can do a whole world of good for everybody in this state. Everybody. But we got to start with that point. How about another issue that bothers me? Hey, incomes are up in the state, growing faster in the U.S. That makes me happy. Taxable sales growth growing faster here than retail spending in the nationwide. All good news. But again, people in Sacramento, they're all very happy about the fact that we have lots of money coming in the coffers right now. But the problem, we're getting all that money because of the capital markets. See, because of Prop 13, we've had to dip deeper and deeper into personal income tax. Prop 30 made it even more so. We have the highest marginal tax rates in the nation. No, look, honestly, I'm not fussed about that. You want to soak the rich? Fine. Dude, go ahead. I don't care. I know better to know that income taxes are that big of a diminishment of effort. But remember that room full of first graders drinking espresso? That is now our state budget. We have internalized the chaos in the stock markets in our budget system. We've seen this play out before. We saw it in 2000. We saw it in 2006. Massive budget deficits appear overnight when the capital markets tank. That's not a way to run a state. We got to get off this train. We got to rebuild our revenue system. Because guess what? Whatever's there now will disappear like that the next time there's a market meltdown. But no one's talking about it. They just want to extend Prop 30. Haven't we learned anything? Come on. We can have a real conversation about this. Not hard. How about local growth? What's happening here? Well, Kern, near the bottom of the list, 1.2%, one of the slowest growing ones. Now, you know, a few months ago, it was actually down. It's starting to come back just a little bit. This is obviously oil. No doubt about it. But here's the key. As bad as the oil situation is, as much as the slowdown has occurred, the county is still growing. There's still good numbers out there. And you look at the numbers going on right now. What's growing? Retail trade, education's up, government's up, hospitality's up, logistics is up. All good, solid growth numbers here. The only part of the economy that's down, obviously construction wrapped around oil. Mining, of course, is down 21%, lost 2,700 jobs there. Manufacturing down just a little bit as well. There's no doubt the county is taking a bit of a hit right now. But again, take a step back. Let's get a little perspective on this. Let's look about things in the long run. Look, Kern has been one of the fastest growing economies. There was barely a recession here compared to the rest of the U.S., compared to the rest of the state. Right now, compared to 2000, this area has 35% more jobs compared to 15% overall for the state. These are good numbers. Unemployment is continuing to fall here as well. Yes, it's a bump in the road, but that's just it. It's a bump in the road. Just like Dallas is working its way through, just like Houston is working its way through, so is Kern County. So don't let what's happening in oil think that means Kern's going to slow down or even stop growing. Not at all. The fundamentals, what's going on here, are fairly important. And you know, that's true for most of the South San Joaquin Valley. We did a study not too long ago for the area here. And I hear some of the rhetoric, unemployment rates are high, the area's in a depression. Read a book before you start making pronouncements like that. The South Central Valley does have a high unemployment rate. Why? Because of ag. When you have ag, you have to have low-skilled workers to deal with that. And low-skilled workers, by definition, have a very high unemployment rate. That's just the nature of the beast. As long as you have ag, your unemployment rate's going to be higher than the rest of the United States. Simple as that. And that's okay. The key is the trends for unemployment. And look at the unemployment. Look at it here. You know, in the middle of it was about 16%. Right now it's down to about 10%. So things are fine. And if you look at the Central Valley, all the big growth that's been going on here, and you say, well, what does it mean? For the four counties, Fresno, Kern, Kings, Tulare, you're talking 2.5 million people. That's more people than New Mexico. Aggregate output here is about $68 billion. That's more than Hawaii or West Virginia. This is a big, rapidly growing economy you're sitting in the middle of. This is an exciting place. Yes, there's a bump on the road. Forget the bump. It'll be behind you, and there's lots of other things going on here. Take, for example, economic output. Again, growing much more rapidly here than the rest of the state, or as the rest of the United States overall. Mining is a big part of that, 25% of the increase. One-fourth of the increase in output over the last 15 years or so is wrapped around oil production. But finance is up there, ag is up there, wholesale is up there, professional is up there, healthcare is up there, manufacturing is up there. In other words, there's plenty of other sectors that are going to continue to thrive. And once you move through the oil slowdown, all these other sectors are going to start growing. Just a function of paying attention to the fact that there's lots of other things happening in the local economy. And you certainly see that in taxable sales as well. It is true, of course, that some places like Taft or Arvin are down, but on the other hand, Ridgecrest and Wasco and Delano are heading up in terms of sales. There are people are buying stuff. And last but not least, I want to talk about housing, state housing. You know, we have been so proud, if you will, the fact that our state's growing so rapidly, almost 3% on a year-on-year basis in terms of job growth. Labor force is only growing at 1%. That only works when you have slack in the labor force, a high unemployment rate. But now unemployment in state continues to fall. We're getting to the point where suddenly there's very little in the way of slack left in the labor market. If we want the state to continue to grow rapidly, it means having a workforce to do that. Unfortunately, we're not building housing for it. Housing right now is becoming very, very expensive, and this is primarily a supply phenomenon. Look, single family has barely come back. Multifamily has come back, but single family barely has. Overall, new population permits in the state, about 4-1. We're already underbuilding in the midst of what we already have in terms of a housing shortage. Now, locally, prices are going up as well. You can see a little better numbers in terms of permit, about 2,100 new permits in 2015 compared to the previous year. Some recovery, but still relatively slow. Now, there's no bubble. Again, this is not a function of prices getting too far or too out of themselves. In fact, if you account for interest rates, turns out housing is still affordable in California in our own shockingly unaffordable sort of way. We have one of the worst overcrowding sales, you can see, one of the lowest vacancy rates out there today. Why don't we build enough housing? Very simple, CEQA Prop 13. CEQA, the California Environmental Quality Act, as we know, the regulation that while well-intentioned has been used and abused by every special interest and NIMBY to fight against anything, anywhere, anytime, all the time, no matter what, I don't care what it is. And of course, Prop 13, our beloved property tax system, which not only forces us to be more and more reliant on that hyperactive personal income tax revenue stream, but also which diminishes the incentive for local cities to invest in housing. Look, sit down with a finance person in a city. You got 20 acres of land. What do you want to do with it? Go through the list. I want retail. Lots of tax revenues, doesn't cost me anything. If I can't have that, I want other kinds of commercial. If I can't have that, I'll suffer with single family. Last but not least, what I do not want is multifamily residential. It's very low tax base, costs me tons in terms of services used, from roads to police to ambulance to schools. That's a loser. I don't want it. If you want cities to build housing, if you want cities to fight against the NIMBYs using CEQA, you have to incentivize them to want that kind of housing. You can't just waggle a finger and say you should do it because you should do it. Any policy that relies on better nature of human beings to succeed is going to fail. And you know, I like to say this more than anything else. If you don't believe me about housing, take a look at this. This is net migration in and out of California. You will hear this story all the time. People flee California because of high taxes. Actually, no. High-income people are more likely to move into California than leave. It's low-income folks who leave the state, and that, of course, is because of high housing costs. That is the primary driver of people leaving the state, not taxes. And indeed, that actually is good for Kern County at some level. Because when you have the reluctance to build enough housing in the core part of Southern California, and like it or not, you're part of Southern California, that pushes growth to the periphery. Look, if you look at what's going to happen in this state over the next 20 years, this is a projection straight from the Department of Finance. Los Angeles is going to add 976,000 people in the next 20 years. That's 9% growth rate. Kern County is projected to add 400,000, almost half as much as LA. That's a 44% growth rate. Why are they coming here? Because of housing, because you could build, because you could do things here. So forget about oil. There's a lot coming down the pike. This here area has huge growth potential because California has growth potential, and you're part of that growth margin, as the case may be. So I got some forecasts here. I'll let you chew on that. We'll have these slides available for you so you can look at them later. But we're looking for return to normalcy. Job growth is going to come back. We think that you worked through the worst of the mining situation at this particular point in time. Overall, looking a little longer term down the thing, huge potential for Kern County, huge potential for the city of Bakersfield. So the key here is to make sure that we focus on policy issues that make sure that occurs. Investment in infrastructure, investment in education, investment in housing. It's there. So I'll wrap up very quickly with this. What do you worry about? What you don't worry about? Don't worry about the dollar. Worry about China. Don't worry about student debt. Worry about educational choices. Don't worry about asset bubbles. Don't worry about bad financial regulations. Don't worry about drought. Worry about water policy. Don't worry about labor markets. Worry about growing wealth inequality. Don't worry about business. Worry about California housing. Don't worry about California tax levels. Worry about California tax structure. Don't worry about politics. You know, that's the last thing. I'll say this. I'm going to go back to my first message where I said, look, I'm watching this presidential debates and it makes me crazy. I listen to what talked about in terms of what's important and what's not, and I see him missing the point. But the key here, of course, is about political engagement. There are relatively simple solutions to the problems that bedevil us. You don't need a PhD in economics to understand these things, these solutions. What you do need a PhD in is psychology to understand why somehow or other our political leaders have completely divorced themselves from the reality of the ground level situation. But part of that's being involved. Part of that is having conversation. Part of that is standing up here the way I'm in front of you and talking about the real issues and to understand that there is a middle ground. There's a way of dealing with these things that's good for everyone. Thank you very much, everybody. Have a good couple years.
Chris, thank you very much for that. We appreciate it a lot. Our next speaker, Robin Padgey, is the training coordinator at WorkLogic HR, where she creates and delivers training on topics such as harassment prevention, communication, and supervisory skills. Robin is a senior professional in human resources with a state-specific certification in California. She's a certified professional in learning and performance, a certified professional coach, a certified DISC personality profile trainer, and a master practitioner of the Myers-Briggs Type Indicator. Robin holds master's degrees in communication studies and human resource development. So would you please help me welcome Robin Padgey and her panel.
And my panel members can make their way up here. And while they're doing, why is everybody leaving the room? So we're waiting until everybody comes back from potty before we get started, I'll just tell you that. I'd like to let you know also that I do moisturize. I look a lot younger in my head than I do in person or on TV, though that's unfortunate. There we go. Good morning. Yes, just have a seat wherever you would like. So I'm going to introduce these people a little bit later and why they're here. And what we're going to do is talk about the different generations. So Chris already got the generation bashing started. So thank you, Chris. And Chris has left the building. Chris didn't tell you his wife is due at any moment, and so he needs to go home. And yeah, all the ladies went, ah, the guys are gone. Yeah, we don't care. So the generation bashing has begun, and if you didn't get some of his jokes, then I will tell you what the generations are like in general so that you get the joke. One of the things also is that I want to point out that different people call the different generations different names, and they also have different timelines of birth dates. And so we need to come to a consensus about what we're going to call folks. I know that Ryan has different names for his generations than I have for mine. I'm up at the podium now, and I am older than you, Ryan, so I get to name them, and then you have to change your PowerPoint in order to go along with what I'm about to tell you. Now, it really doesn't matter what we call the generations, and we need to understand we are generalizing. Everybody doesn't fit nicely into these generations. It gives us an idea, though, of where we need to start conversations. So when we're talking about generations, we'll see if my little clicker works here. All right, see, I'm over 40, so I don't know how to work the technology. Can somebody under 30 come up here and help me work the technology? That would be lovely, please. Seriously. Robin, that's all you need to do. All right, very good. All right, so we're back. Yay! So the events and conditions each of us experienced during our formative years help define our worldview. What's our formative years? 14 to 18, roughly. So what was going on in high school has shaped us as people. Yay, that's exciting news if you went to high school when I did it and where I did. So the generation that we grew up in is just one of the many influences that we have, but I do prescribe to this. And one of the examples I will give you is, what is the best music ever? The stuff that you heard in high school, right? Yes, some of you are saying no, I beg to differ, and Fleetwood Mac and Queen are the best bands, so there you go. All right, so we're gonna look at the different generations. Now, the oldest generation in the workforce, and yes, there are still some of these folks. So look at these dates, born between 1930 and 1945, and I think Ryan's dates differ a little bit. He also calls them traditionalists while I call them veterans. They're also called the greatest generation, radio babies, whatever. There are still some of them in the workplace. One of our panelists is going to tell you she has employees in her 80s. They will not go away. Yes, so my dad is turning 80 next week, still goes to work every single day, and he plans to die at work, and that's what he wants, and we'll just move him into storage, and we'll keep on going. So what was happening during their formative years? Well, we know the story, the crash, the depression, World War II. Look at what they were watching at the movies, as opposed to what we're watching at the movies these days. The New Deal, which Roosevelt created to get people back to work, and that work was mostly manual labor. So as a result of growing up during that time and shortly thereafter, okay, seriously, you're just gonna have to click the button. Yay, all right. They tend to have a practical outlook. What does that mean? They don't like to spend money. Their work ethic is dedicated, and so they tend to stay at one job for most of their lifetime if they possibly can. They respect people in positions of authority. Because you're in a position of authority, you probably earned it. And because you're older than I am, and I always learned to respect my elders, I will give you respect. That has changed tremendously for very good reason. Leadership by hierarchy, or hierarch that I have there. And they believe in sacrifice. You sacrifice before you play. They're very civic-minded for the most part, and make do or do without. And so if you're like me and you were raised by veterans, you were given a credit card to use only in case of emergencies. And if you ever had an emergency, you better be dying, because that's the only emergency they recognize. So spending, putting things on credit was not something that these folks did. If you don't have the money, you don't get it. All right, so here are the boomers. I was amazed to find out I'm in this group. I thought my parents were the boomers, and I was like, no, yeah, if you're born before 1964, you're a boomer too. Sorry to burst your bubble if you didn't know that already. So the older boomers, and this generation is 18 years And so the older boomers were doing Vietnam and civil rights and integration, sexual revolution. I wanted to have a picture up there about the sexual revolution, but I was told it was inappropriate, especially as an HR person. So I took it down. All right, and the space race. So as a result of living through this stuff, and by the way, if you're a younger boomer like me, born between 1960 and 1964, we have our own special designation. Of course we do, because we're special. And that designation is Generation Jones, because about when we were hitting graduation in the 1980s, it was Dynasty and all of these big houses, big mansions, big hair, big shoulder pads. You were, if you were in the 80s, you were there, big hair, big shoulder pads, purple eyeshadow, yeah. So keeping up with the Joneses became the motto at that point. And so we're Generation Jones. So I feel especially cool. Don't, because most of us go to prison and have illegitimate children. So that's what happened with that. Yeah, it was all that free love stuff that happened before us. So. All right, so how are boomers? Optimistic. We're good team players. We got credit in school for participation. Yeah, we think the millennials are the babies and handholders. No, we got participation points. But we tend to be very driven and take our work very seriously, and we love titles to demonstrate how serious and important that we are. View of authority. We hated it as when we were younger. Don't trust people in positions of authority. But now that we're in positions of authority, we love it. And we want to be respected because we're there. Let's lead by consensus. Let's all play as a team. Personal gratification. I am trying to get plastic surgery. My husband won't pay for it. Perspective. Let's all work together as a team. The Gen Xers who are cynical. Yeah, they hate that stuff. Don't try it. It doesn't work. And be anything you want to be, because during our formative years, all of these careers that were never heard of before came to light. And women could have equal rights and go to college. There are more women going to college now than men are. And getting degrees and being all that you can be, and that's what worked. And so that's what we still believe. We don't want to retire, most of us. Somebody asked me the other day, are you retired yet? I hit her and then told her, I have 20 more years until I'm retiring. Don't force me out. I'm in my prime. All right. So that's just a little tidbit for you, Ryan. All right. What else? So here's those cynical Gen Xers. I think Chris was a fine representative of them. And so what was going on? Now, this is 1965 through 1976. The only clear dates of any of the generations is the boomers. Why? Because the birth rate skyrocketed after the war, and then it fell in 1964. Why did it fall? Birth control was invented. Yeah. Gen X is the smallest generation. There are about five of you who raised your hands. Yay, I'm Gen X. Yeah, you're overnumbered. Keep your hand down. All right. So what was happening to make these people so darn skeptical? Divorce, because the women's movement allowed women to get into the workforce. Single parents, latchkey kids. So here's a big clue. Lots of them were taking care of themselves, and sometimes younger siblings while their parents are at work. That's why they're so darn independent. Watergate and Iran-Contra. So people in positions of authority can't really trust them when your president has to leave office and he still insists on the way into the helicopter. I am not a crook. You remember it, watching it on TV. Yeah, Sally Ride and Vanessa Williams. So women in space and Miss America, and women can be all they can. And then technology boom. These were the ones. Now, boomers, we were alive during the technology boom, but some of us didn't embrace it. Gen X embraced it and ran with it. And that's part of their expectations. So here's that skeptical word, yeah. Balanced. So while the boomer parents are finding themselves and their identity at work and working those long, hard hours to demonstrate that they're good team players, Generation X was at home going, yeah, I'd rather have a life outside of my workplace, and I will make that happen, thank you. And I will only be working 40 hours a week, or 50 if I absolutely have to, and then I'm gonna go home and have a life. View of authority, unimpressed. Just because you're in a position of authority, don't tell me what to do. Leadership by competence. You want to be my leader? Prove it. a reluctance to commit to organizations as well, because if you can't give me what I need, then I'm moving on. And not only that, I was chagrined to read on Monster.com advice by them that if you are young and if you are in a job for 2 years and you have not gotten a raise or a promotion, you need to get out because you're a loser. All right, so that's the advice by Monster.com to younger people. Perspective, it's all about me, and don't count on it. They're a skeptical, unimpressed generation, so good luck working with that. All right, so I call them Gen Y. Ryan calls them millennials. I'm at the podium. I get to name them. Gen Y, so around 1975, 1995, somewhere around there, and what was happening to these folks? Well, they grew up on technology. And if you're like me, your five-year-old grandchild can work technology better than you can. Yes, so they expect it. They like it. It makes life easier. They don't know life without it. Clean Air Act and the ADA. So we had some stuff coming into our environment and to our government to make us behave and to keep things clean for the next next generation. Columbine. So this is a generation that started to see unsafety everywhere. And now we have school shootings almost every day. We have a mass murder, which is considered 4 people being killed at one time. We have a mass murder every day in the United States. This is what this generation is growing up with. Clarence Thomas and Anita Hill. So sexual harassment's been against the law since 1964, but it really took off in the early 90s with the televisation of this hearing. And so those of you who are too young to know what I'm talking about, this lady went and said a nominee for a Supreme Court judge had sexually harassed her. And then the lawsuits started, and those of us who are in HR and employment law, thank you, Anita Hill. So Operation Desert Storm. We're back at war. Clinton and Lewinsky, we have the president. Now, he wasn't the first one who had sex with an intern in the White House. He wasn't the first one, but he did go on TV and lie about it. And most people, I remember, said, well, everybody lies about their sex life, so who cares? That's what the generation that's watching this was taught. By the way, more people admit to cheating on their college exams than ever before, and they're admitting it because you got to cheat in order to get ahead. So that's what they were taught. And then, of course, 9/11 happened. Now, we all experienced 9/11, but when you're 10 years old or 12 years old or 14 years old and you're watching those towers come down, it's a lot different than when you're 35 years old, which is how old I was. So what happens to us during our formative years has a huge impact on our worldview. And so what's Gen Y like? Well, they're hopeful. Why in the heck are they hopeful? What do they have to be hopeful about? Well, Chris told us the economy's good. We're good. That's all I heard. I was a communication major, so I didn't understand most of what he talked about. All I heard was, you're okay, and so I'm going shopping. So, work ethic. Work ethic, ambitious. They're ambitious. No, they're not. They're a bunch of slackers. No, they're not. They are ambitious, and Monster.com is telling them you need to start rising up in the ranks, and they want to do that. By the way, those of us who went to college, which is probably just about everybody in the room, don't you remember when you were in college and people were telling you you need to get degrees because you'll get that corner office and more money if you do? We were all told that. Thank you, CSUB. Got 2 of my degrees there. And we were told that, and we believed that. And I, too, when I graduated, wanted that corner office and was not going to make any less than $50,000. And I was a secretary, and I made $25,000. And that's how that worked. So we can't blame people or fault people for thinking that college degree is going to get them stuff, because that's what we were all told. All right, leadership by achievers. So they want to be achievers. They want to be led by achievers. Just because you're in a position of authority doesn't mean you know what you're talking about. Our president lied about having sex in the White House with an intern on TV. And so just because you're in the position of authority doesn't mean you know what you're talking about. They tend to be loyal as long as you are in a relationship with them. Their perspective is civic. They grew up having to do community service as part of school. Now, if you're a boomer, you might have done community service too. You're wearing an orange jumpsuit and you were picking up trash. Community service means different things. Not that I would know. Community service means different things for these folks. And they were told, you're special. You are special. It's your fault, all right? It's your fault because of the fracking stuff. It's your fault because of oil. It's also your fault for the younger generations thinking they're special. You raised them. And so that's what happened. So, next generation. Now, Ryan calls the next generation Gen Z, and nobody's got a name for them yet. People are trying them out. So Gen 2020, iGen, I like Gen, iGen. iPhone, iPad, iPod, iGen, it makes sense. Gen Z, okay, Linksters, somebody came up with that. Yeah, it's not, so we don't know what they are. But roughly, these are the folks born after 1996. And so this is a definition that I heard that I really liked. It was, if you were too young to remember 9/11, you're in this generation. If you remember 9/11 where you were, you're in the previous one. I like that distinction. That makes sense to me. All right, so technologically dependent, not necessarily savvy, dependent. I had people coming to my house to clean my carpet. I live on 20th Street, and I told them where I address. They called me. They were in front of the Greyhound bus station. They said, do you live at the Greyhound bus station? I said, not yet. And they said, well, we don't know how to get to your house because we put it into Google Maps, and we don't know how to get there. And I said, you're on 18th Street. I live on 20th Street. Figure it out. And they said, no, really, can you tell us? I had to tell them. That's scary. All right. Closely tied to their parents, tolerant of alternative lifestyles because they have lived amongst boys wearing makeup and girls playing World Cup soccer and all sorts of stuff that is different than older generations, and involved in green causes and social activism. And so they'd like time off work to go read to students in elementary school, and they'd like you to pay them while they're there. Not necessarily a bad thing. All right, so that's them in a nutshell. Okay. Oh, here we go. Oh, now we went too far. There we go. All right then. So we have a panel of folks up here. And who are these people? Well, they represent industry leaders and managers and people all over Kern County. So we really tried to represent the entire Kern County here. So we have Sandra Bloxham. And Sandra is, I've got it, the employee manager at Grimway. Let me get everybody's title. Employee relations manager at Grimway. So we've got South Kern County representative. Then we have Aurora Cooper, who is the chief human resources officer at Omni Family Health. Now they're here in Bakersfield. They also have some locations in North Kern, so we've got North Kern represented. Shauna Shearson, Kern Schools Federal Credit Union, and Shauna is the vice president of contact center and training in the communication center located right here in Bakersfield. So we got Central Kern. And then we have Harris Starkey, who is the general manager of West Kern Water District. So we've got Taft, so we've got West Kern. And then we have Jennifer Wood, who is the mayor of California City, so we've got East Kern here. So we've got representatives from throughout the industries and the region, and they are here to tell us some of the problems they have encountered, not with millennials, we're not just going to bash millennials, but the managing five different generations in the workplace. So, Sandra, there you are. Oh, good morning. Let's start with you.
Good morning, everyone. Well, basically, I work in the agricultural industry, and not only are we tasked with working with different generations, but we're also tasked with working with different minorities, which is something actually we hadn't touched on yet. And, you know, our preconceived notion of what we think each generation expects is also sometimes very much structured around our family lifestyle, just like Robin mentioned. But the problem is we have to remember culturally there may be a difference as well. So even though you may be dealing with a generation, you may have an anticipation of how you feel they may want to be managed or treated at the workplace. What you have to remember is the influence that they have at home, which for us can be a challenge. We have very savvy, intelligent employees that work for us, but their home life is very different. And so sometimes it takes a little more time to figure out what makes them tick and understanding better how to make them feel welcomed, be motivated, and of course, learning what will help them in their growth. So for us, that's been the challenge, is understanding not only the generation we're working with, but understanding the formation of their way of being.
Great, okay.
Aurora.
Hi, good morning, everyone. So I work with Omni Family Health, so we have health centers throughout Kern County. A lot of the things that we have to deal with is, as an employer, we have every single generation working for us, even the traditionalists. So some of the biggest things that we have is the expectation that each generation has on another. So for example, I have several, talking about managers, a lot of managers within different of the traditionalists, baby boomers, and Gen Xers are supervising the Gen Ys, and we have several millennials. I call them millennials, sorry. So the younger ones, we have several of those. They compose of, I think, maybe 40%, and then we have Gen Ys that are composed of at least 60, It was about 3/4 of our employees. So our supervisors are having, one of the biggest things, the challenges that I have also is we do need to educate them on the different, we educate them a lot on the diversity. However, it's educating them on the differences in the different generations. So we have people like Robin Padgy coming in and helping us with that. So what we're having to do is basically having them understand the diversity on the differences that we have and focusing the problems that we have on work. So we have a lot of new staff who come in. Like I said, it's at least 3/4 of the, our employee population and is having to have an understanding of what each one of them, what expectation is. We do have to train the younger generations on what the expectations are. The older generations are having to explain more what the expectation is. It's not so much of this is the way they should know how to do it. We actually have to explain that to all of them. And the biggest thing is also all generations want the same thing, which is respect. Our older generations want respect on their experience, others on professionalism, and the younger generation want on their ideas and what they bring to the table. So they just want to be heard. So that's kind of some of the things that we're having to deal with.
I can echo what Sandra and Aurora said are some of the challenges that we have, and boils down to expectations and different communication styles. We have a lot of tellers, and those tend to be young people, either millennials / Gen Y, or even now some Generation Z team members coming up, and they're being supervised by people in older generations, and they have different expectations, and so we do a lot of resetting of expectations and teaching the young people how to work in our workplace, and also trying to show that they are valued, trying to keep some harmony there. I do want to share one particular issue, that this being the Economic Summit, it comes down to sort of a financial issue for us that I'm working on right now. As being responsible for training, I have to look at how the different generations learn, and technology is a big issue with that. We have a position that's our new account loan officer position, which is has a lot of technical and software tasks required, but it also is a sales position, so it requires that the people have great interpersonal skills and sales skills. And typically, we promote from within and groom over time. We're opening the Delano branch, like next week, I hope, maybe this week. And anyway, so that's imminent. And so we found ourselves in a position where we needed to hire this position from the outside. And so we have hired some experienced, more mature workers because we're looking for that professional maturity and finding that in someone who's had more life experience. We also have multiple software programs that are pretty complex, and so we're trying to teach them and finding it's taking a long time for our mature workers. And they're my age, you know, but I took a typewriter to college. My kids have grown up with a computer, and the millennials, I think they've all had access to that, so they approach it from a different place. So now I'm wondering if that's the way to go, or if it's it's really makes more sense to take some agile minds and teach them the tasks and then focus the training efforts on professional maturity, sales skills, and interpersonal skills. And assuming that we could achieve the same excellent result for our members in either direction, then I have to look at what's the more economic way of going about that. So that's something that is a challenge, a current challenge for me.
Great. Harry.
Good morning. Well, so for me, I think what's been interesting to observe in the millennials is the gender shift in potential leaders. I'm looking at my organization and succession planning, and it's really easy to identify leaders in female millennials. It's very difficult in the male millennials. And so, I mean, look at our panel. You can see there's a shift in gender leadership. And I think it's a good thing. And so I think one of the things I struggle with in my blue-collar workforce is identifying those young men. Blue-collar tends to be more male-oriented, is identifying those boys that can be leaders in the future. So I think that's interesting. Another kind of anecdotal thing that's interesting with millennials is not only are you drawn into texting in terms of communicating with them, but you're also required to include emojis so that the context of your communication, and there is a difference between an emoji and an emoticon, and I refuse to use emojis with my employees, but I will put a smiley face once in a while. They really want to know that, hey, am I okay? So I also think that the traditional, I come from a military, I'm a baby boomer, I feel very old up here, and I was raised by a military father, and so my idea of the buttoned-up strong leader is my idea of how I lead, but I think that's an obsolete model. I think that how we interact with these millennials is really different. I think you have to, there's so many things competing for their attention. And I think you have to create an extremely varied workforce, an interesting workforce. You have to create opportunities for them to collaborate and work in teams. I mean, the social media has brought these guys together like we never thought. And I think you have to, the traditional way of doing tasks, setting goals, and running in a straight line to the finish line is obsolete. These guys want to zigzag and go through all different kinds of hoops, and it keeps them interesting. Keeps it interesting for them. And I think the management bluff is over. I think that you have to be very authentic if you're in leadership with millennials. And they can see when you're not bought in to the things that you're requiring of them. And so if you're not going to live it, don't preach it with millennials. They're very savvy. I think that they've had this compressed experience of interacting with people through social media, and they're much more, in my opinion, have higher emotional IQ than I ever did, at that age. So those are my perspectives.
Thank you much. And Jennifer.
Well, thank you very much. I feel like I have the easy last position, and I have to agree with Harry right away in how you're dealing with the millennials and your younger employees in the workforce, that when they come in the door, many times, depending on the profession, you're spending between $27,000 to $50,000 to bring them in the door. And I say that for careers like law enforcement and public safety, because you're doing a lot of psychologicals. There's a lot of things that you have to do, plus the training. And I speak from a municipal standpoint and also a Department of Defense standpoint, because I'm a veteran. And so I've worked in both arenas. I am not an employer, I'm an observer. And one thing that I can say about management is, the traditional manager has to be able to work with these employees and articulate all the way down the chain through the levels of supervision that they have what the policies are, what the procedures are, how does everybody treat it in the workplace, how do they, resolve their problems. Because what's happening is you're getting a highly motivated, you've spent a lot of money to bring this person on board, you have a highly motivated employee, and after 2 years, they come in wanting to contribute greatly to the organization, but they feel as if they see double standards based on the other ages in the workforce. What you're allowing this, what this manager is allowing certain employees of the peer group to do is different from others. So it's kind of like, it's kind of like the not exciting part of what I'm trying to tell you, but I think if you have clear policies and a chain of command in your organization, and you know how to engage these young people that are in your workforce, I mean, the thing to get more value out of them and get more loyalty out of them, and what I'm observing is you have to engage them in the process of improving the organization, and they have to feel that they have input for success. Because lacking that, unfortunately, because of the excitement and the many things, many directions that they want to go in, they'll get to the point where they're not happy, and they will go and find another job, not necessarily a better job, just another job where they feel, you know, like they're more part of the organization, you know. And I like to say that our employees are our lifeblood. Whether you're in a corporation, a small business, you work for government in any level, you really need to retain these people. And if you don't find the creative ways to do that and employ folks that can help you with the training and help you with the tools that you need, you're going to constantly, in some businesses, and some, you're going to constantly be making that, let's say worst case, $50,000 investment to get a person in the door. And you want to try to, we don't have that kind of money. A lot of us don't have that kind of money to pay. So I would just say that recognize their contributions, know how to communicate with them, and be consistent with them and other employees in the workforce. That's what I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Here are some things that research has demonstrated that folks have had some challenges with or some clashes with. Work ethic. So older people think younger people don't have one. And one of the reasons for that is because older people tend to think your work ethic is demonstrated by the amount of hours you put in on the job. Younger people disagree. Learn to use your computer. You can get home earlier. Establish ways of doing business. We've always done it this way. No, get rid of that. Technical competence and comfort, there we go. And our IT guy is fed up with showing me which buttons to push, so I need to write this down. Loyalty, older people think younger people don't have it. You job hop. Balancing work and family, younger people tend to want to do it. Older people want you to be dedicated to your job. How do we know you're dedicated? By the hours you put in. Yeah. Perks, people want different stuff. I had a Gen Y manager give me a day off with pay as a thank you. I didn't want a day off with pay. I'm just going to be home working. I wanted more money. Come on, give me more money or give me a title, either one, or a bigger office. People skills, older people think that younger people don't have it. Notions of gender roles. By the way, you can't only hire men for certain jobs. Don't know if you've gotten that memo yet. Change, and younger people, that's part of the deal. You change constantly. I mean, how old is your iPhone? Come on. All right, so one of the things that I've experienced with some of my clients is the amount of feedback. This is just one of the examples, the amount of feedback that people give. So veterans were raised with no news is good news. If my manager is not talking to me, I'm doing okay, and that's just how I want to keep it. Just under the radar and don't look at me. Boomers created the performance evaluation. I'll talk to you once a year, and I'll document it in case you sue me. Xers, sorry to interrupt, but how am I doing? And, you know, look at me a little bit more. And Yers, feedback whenever I want it at the push of a button. And so I had a young woman helping me set up for a workshop one day, very carefully putting all the handouts on the table. I thought she was going too slow myself, but I didn't say anything. And when she got done putting the papers on the table, she said to me, "Did I do a good job or what?" Yeah, that's what my boomer mentality said. I said, "Yeah, you did a great job putting papers on a table. Good for you." I didn't say that. I said, "Yes, you did. I appreciate how conscientious you were. Thank you." Now, it took me, oh, you're laughing at that. All right. It took me 3 seconds to say it. Why did I say it? Because that's what she needed to hear. And why do I say it? Because I need her to do a good job for me. It takes me 3 seconds. I can invest that time. All right. So another, veterans have a tendency not to question or challenge authority or the status quo. And Xers and Yers may be confused by that because they've been taught to question authority. And Xers and Yers may fail to listen to veterans and boomers because we talk too long and have too many stories, all right? If you want them to listen, put it in 140 characters or less with some emojis. Thank you. All right. So the panel has already come up with some of the things that they've come up with, but I want to give those who have not already made their solutions known some things that they've come up with, and then I'll tell you what the research says. And then we have Ryan to tell us all about it and wrap it up. All right, so who would like to add anything? Harry, anything to what you've said before?
I think I'm tapped out right now.
Okay, Harry has problems, no solutions. All right, Sandra.
I'll speak up.
Okay.
I got your back, Harry.
Thank you.
Well, for us, it's, you know, something that another panel member brought up is also investing time in training and learning different ways to communicate. We've also, our company's also utilized Robin services, and we found that not only is it informative, but it's also provides a lot of aha moments for our managers that never really thought how they manage certain generations was received or how more effective they could be if they learned to recognize the individual and their needs. So, you know, one of the things, for example, that came to mind while Robin was speaking is ADA. ADA is something that affects our older generation at the workplace for obvious reasons. There may be some health issues that develop as they're older. But in our younger generation, surprisingly enough, we get a lot of accommodation requests as well because they're very aware of what's available. And so for me, it's an interesting, you know, dynamic in that our older generation and our younger generation are conscious of the same issue. And that's something that I never really would have thought of had I not actually see it evolve. And so for me, it's really just listening and understanding what forms of communication we can offer, what type of training will benefit our staff, and encouraging involvement, because some of our managers don't like training, and we have to remind them that it's going to benefit them. And of course, you know, we force them to sometimes, but but we want to make sure that they understand that overall it's going to benefit them and their group. And so for us, that's been very successful, is reaching out to outside resources for training.
Oh, he does have one. Yeah. I just wanted to say that this, I chose the panel, but I did not tell them to tell you to hire me. So I just want to make that clear. All right.
Okay. Well, and this is going to be a plug for Robin, one of the things that I have found in those, you know, it's easy to manage easy people, but it's those tough people that you just can't seem to connect with. And one of the things that's unlocked that beyond understanding millennials and Gen Xers and those kinds of things is personality typing. And I'm a huge believer in Myers-Briggs. And with those individuals where I just can't figure out how to get through to them, Myers-Briggs has unlocked kind of that key to understanding this. It's not that they're bad or I'm good or I'm right or they're wrong or whatever. It's just they're a different type of person. They communicate differently. They understand things differently, and they might not understand what I'm trying to communicate. So, Robin does this kind of training, and you can do it online. It's a great way to kind of unlock some of these difficult relationships you have in the workforce.
One of the things we've talked about is technology and the differences we approach those. I have teenage sons, and at a recent freshman orientation in high school, they talked about the BYOD policy, and I'm like, what is that? And they said, bring your own device. And they were actually instructing my child to bring his cell phone or his smartphone or iPad to school. And it blew my mind because I can't comprehend this. And it's an issue that we really struggle with our frontline team members especially. They want to have their cell phones with them at all times. And so some solutions to deal with that, I think first and foremost, are looking, re-examining your policies. When is it okay to have a cell phone? When is it it and communicating that clearly and really working with that. The other thing that we do is when it's not as important when they're not serving a member, for instance, especially in our training classes, instead of going 2 hours and then taking a break, we're taking actually tech breaks about every 45 minutes to an hour. So they're shorter breaks, but you can pull out your cell phone now and look at that, and then trying to keep the distraction away. So the re-examining those policies and not just having a no policy that's not working, kind of taking a tip from the public schools at this point.
There you go. Aurora?
Just like mentioned before, you know, the knowledge, having knowledge, especially your managers, the ones dealing with the employees, them knowing the difference in the generations and what helps. It just helps build their ability to be able to have better conversations. So and increasing the chances of them being heard by the employees and understood better. Because if they show the understanding of the other person's perspective, it's just that's pretty much helps reduce the tension in the conversation and have be able to have them listen to you and have them engaged. So that's all I have to say.
Jennifer?
Well, Robin, time's up, so I'll make it just short and sweet. Learn how to communicate with the different levels in your workplace. Make sure that you recognize your employees, and it can be something, you don't have to give them money, because I found that some of the younger employees that are in our city or even in the military are not motivated by money. They're motivated more by being part of a team, being part of the solution, being dedicated to their job. So, I mean, just sometimes just in a work meeting or a briefing, recognize their, just something as simple as recognize and act in front of their peers. But it's real simple. Thank you, Rob.
Thank you. Well, and so just to wrap up here, people are different. And with the generations, we have generalizations. It gets the conversation started. Continue the conversation. The basic life principle is this, and aren't you lucky that you're here to hear it? This is it. So if you're on your phones, put them down. This is it. Give people what they need, and they will give you what you need. So get the conversation started, find out what they need from you. And finally, everybody wants to be a part of the workforce. Everybody has something to offer. Let them and benefit from that. Thank you.
Well, that was a great presentation. I appreciate that, Robin, very much. Suddenly, I feel very old. I don't know why that is. It's my privilege and pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Horace Mitchell. He's the president of California State University Bakersfield. Appointed in 2004, he has led CSUB to national recognition with a vision to extend the excellence and diversity of faculty and academic programs, enhance the quality of the student experience, and strengthen the university's community engagement. And as you've seen in recent sports news, he has been at the forefront of leading California State University Bakersfield to Division I and the runners to their first ever playoffs in March Madness. Yeah. So with that spirit of Go Runners, I want you to show your appreciation to the California State University Bakersfield Roadrunners and to Dr. Horace Mitchell as he comes to the podium. Dr. Mitchell.
Thank you, Jeff, and good morning, everyone. In fact, it has been my privilege and honor to serve our community as president at CSU Bakersfield over the past 12 years. And it's my pleasure to introduce our next panel, which will be on local economic conditions and trends. And I'm going to ask them to go ahead and join me on the stage here. And I would add, while they're coming up, that over the last year, CSU Bakersfield has received quite a number of national accolades. And one that I will mention relative to this meeting this morning is that we were ranked by Economist as the number 5 university in the country in terms of the value of the degree in terms of economics as measured by mid-career earnings of graduates. We thought that was pretty good. Thank you. So this next panel consists of three economists from CSUB. And I'll give brief introductions, and of course, the full introductions are in your program. First of all, Dr. Mark Evans is professor and chair of the Department of Economics in the School of Business and Public Administration at CSUB. Previously, he served as associate dean of the school and also as interim dean, and he was also interim dean of our extended university division. He received his PhD from the University of New Mexico and joined the CSUB faculty in 1978. The university was only 8 years old when he joined the university. Second, Dr. Nakundi Micheka, I had to struggle with that a little bit, is assistant professor of economics. He grew up in Kenya, where he earned his undergraduate degree, and he earned his PhD in natural resources and environmental economics from the University of West Virginia. He came to CSUB in September 2014. Third is Dr. Richard Gearhart. He is also assistant professor of economics. He joined the faculty in August of 2014, coming from Clemson University, where he earned his master's degree and PhD in economics. He's also the managing editor of the Kern Economic Journal. I'm going to turn the panel over to Dr. Evans.
Good morning, everyone. Before we get started, I'd like to point out that starting on page 5 of your printed program, we've compiled some, updated some indicators that we hope is useful to you and maybe has some shelf value if you're sitting somewhere a few months from now and wondering what the exactly what the population is or the GDP or whatever. So let us know if what indicators would be of most interest to you if it's not these. And next year we'll adapt. Nakundi, could we start out by, we don't have time to cover everything that's in the printed program, but what's the big picture in terms of how population's been changing in Kern County and how GDP's been changing?
Okay. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Evans, and thank you, Dr. Mitchell, for the wonderful introduction. So what I plan to do, just to answer your question, is I'm going to present two slides. And the first slide will talk about how Kern County's population has been changing between 1981 and 2005. And then the next slide will have a graph of how GDP has been changing. So if we were to look at population between 1981 and 2015, here we're talking about, you know, right around the age where the baby, well, no, actually the millennials were being born. So around that time, you can see the blue line is the population of Kern County, and then we have a red line which shows the population of California. So the one thing that you might notice is during that span of 35 years, Kern County's population actually doubled from about 400,000 to around 874,000, which is where we are today. During that time, California's population did not grow as fast. And one other thing you'll notice from that graph is that between 2000 and 2010, which is the last decade, Kern County's population was growing twice the speed of California. So we were growing much faster. But that speed actually reduced towards, you know, over the last couple of years. And just to put numbers, between 2014 and 2015, Kern County's population grew at 0.65%, and California's population grew at about 0.93%. So we're kind of slowing down and catching up with that. So we're at 874,000 population for Kern County, and this is a number which is very similar. If you were to think of similar-sized populations or counties which have similar sizes as Kern County, you'd find that San Francisco and Ventura were pretty much the same size with San Francisco and Ventura, and New Haven and Hartford in Connecticut. In terms of countries, if Kern County was to be a country, you'd think of it as Fiji, Comoros, or Guyana. California has a population of 38.7 million, which is similar size population as Kenya. So that's where we are in terms of population. What about GDP growth? So on the x-axis, we have time. On the y-axis, we have GDP in billions. And we'll do the same thing. We'll look at how Kern County's population is growing in terms of GDP. And we'll do the same with California and see how that's happening. So the one thing you'll notice is that Kern County's GDP has been growing at a much faster rate than that of California. You can notice that before. So the blue line, again, is for Kern County. And there's a dip which we see, which happened during the time of the recession, which pretty much says that Kern County took, you know, a much harder hit than California in you know, during the recession period. But then we again increased growth, and we were growing faster than California. And this happened up until the last few years. So just to put numbers again into perspective, you have GDP growth over the last 5 years. Bakersfield has been growing much faster than California and USA. We've been growing at 5% on average over those 5 years, over, you know, the last 5 years. But the growth has actually slowed down over the last 1 year.
Great. Yeah. Excuse me. Nikunda, you've been exploring the relationship between oil prices and employment in the county during periods when there were rapid price increases and rapid price decreases. What's it look like?
Okay, thanks. So if you want to, so what we've done is, I'll just give you a graph here. And so we've talked about GDP, and you can look at GDP, you can look at the whole of Kern County, or you can look at different sectors. You can look at the mining sector, you can look at the construction sector, or farm sector. And what we did is, if you were to look at a particular period where oil prices were going up for about a year, and then stop at that point and look at the next 12 months after that period and see how growth is taking place in these sectors, you'll find that the mining sector and the construction sector are quite sensitive in terms of GDP, are quite sensitive to changes in oil prices. So, you know, when we had prolonged oil price increases, the period that followed that, we found that mining and the construction industry were quite sensitive. But the ag, forestry, fishing, and hunting sector and the manufacturing sector were not as sensitive to oil price changes as the mining and the construction. So then there was a study that was put out there, and what these folks did is they said, if oil prices were to decrease by 50%, what do you think we would see in terms of employment at the state level in the United States? So let's look at all the states in the US and say, if oil prices were to decrease by 50%, where do we see a big change in employment? So that shows the map of the US, and the red signifies states where we'd see a large impact in terms of employment. And you'll see that Wyoming gets hit with a 4.3% reduction in employment. You also have North Dakota, which has a 2% decrease in employment, Oklahoma, and then you have the Texas, the West Virginias, and the Louisianas. So this is what's happening at the state level. And what we said is, why don't we look at what's happening at the county level? Because that's where Kern County plays a role. Now, if I was to ask you, ladies and gentlemen, a question, how many people do you think are employed in Kern County's oil and mining sector? Just average. Anyone can answer this question. Pardon? 15, someone said 15,000? 15, 8, right? We're around there. So what we did is, what I'll do now is I'll show you a pie chart which shows the percentage of employees by sector, okay? So in June 2014, you'll find that the oil and gas extraction and the well drilling sector employed 3.55% of the total employees in Kern County. So we're looking at about 12,000 individuals, which is about 2,000 people more than the ones we have at CSU Bakersfield. If you were to look at the other sector, construction employed about 5% of the total employees in Kern County. The manufacturing sector had about 4%. And then the service sector, which is the yellow one, employed about 60% of the employees. We're talking about 209,000 people here. The service sector employs a lot of people. And then the other, the blue is the other industries, which are the farming. So we said, okay, let's look at a snapshot of what's happening in June 2014, and let's look at a snapshot of what's happening in January 2016, about 18 months after the oil prices have actually gone down. Let's see, do we see more people working in the oil industry or farm? What's happening? Okay, let's do the same thing. So we find that, again, the oil and gas and extraction drilling employees reduced. We also saw a reduction in the number of employees in the construction industry, a reduction in the number of employees working in manufacturing, but then the service sector increased, okay? We see an increase in, you know, about 3% from June 2014 to January 2016. So during this period, we're actually seeing more people working in the service industry compared to what we saw a couple of years ago. So while we see some gains, or while we see some losses taking place in one part, we see some gains happening in another sector. With service sector, what we're talking about is we're talking about retail, we're talking about restaurants, we're talking about transportation. You know, when oil prices go down, consumers are left with more disposable income to spend on shopping. We buy food, we go for we now upgrade. We go to, you know, we stop going to Applebee's and maybe go to better restaurants, right? And buy better clothes, maybe, if these are normal goods. So those sectors, we've seen an increase in the number. And then the other, you know, the other sectors, which includes farming, has also reduced. So we've seen a growth in the service providing industry. Now, if you were to look at employment in June 2014 and January 2016, and you're to compare, you'll find that in June 2014, we had Kern County employed about 351,000 people, but this number increased to 353,100. So the number of people employed has actually increased during this period, right? So that's something, that's a plus to think about. So then we said, okay, well, let's do something else. Let's look at how employment is changing, right? Over the last 25 years, which is pretty awesome, right? 25 years, and let's say, well, on average, what usually happens, you know, let's look at periods where we had oil price increases and oil price decreases, and then let's look at the 12 months following that period and see what's actually happening to employment. Do we see employment growth? Do we see employment declining? And let's do that with each sector. Let's look at the top five sectors. So you have a blue line here that is going to take its time to go from one side to the other, which shows the number of employees in construction, and then you have, those are the farming employees. I have another graph here showing, you know, you can see that that's manufacturing slowly making its way. And as after we do that, and then the black line shows the West Texas Intermediate spot prices. So we said, let's look at what's happening every 12 months, you know, during the last 25 years and see what's happening. So in general, over the last 25 years, these are just looking at averages. We're not doing any models here. On average, the oil and gas employment sector, you know, it's very responsive to changes in oil prices. Okay. Construction, again, is responsive to changes in oil prices. Manufacturing sector, it continues to grow despite changes in oil prices. So it's a bit immune. But the one that is quite immune is the service sector, which is not very responsive. So if you're to look at the, you know, the 12 months following a period of increased oil prices going up or prices going down, you'll find that those 12 months for the service sector, not very responsive. It kind of does its own thing. So we then decided that we're going to look at numbers. Let's look at numbers in June 2014 and in January 2016, and let's see what changes we see. The number of employees in oil and gas extraction and well drilling declined by 20%. That's quite a number. But here we're talking about a change from 9,000 people, I mean from 12,000 people to 9,000. So those are, you know, we're talking about 3,000 individuals here. Construction has also gone down. Manufacturing has gone down. Service, we're talking about 220,000 individuals here. This number has actually gone up. And total employment over that period has actually increased. So we're seeing gains again and losses. We're seeing things happening on both sides. So then we ran a paper. There's a study that Dr. Gearhart and I worked on, and we published it. And, you know, what we said is, let's look at how oil prices, you know, oil prices have their own path, and you have employment having its own path. Let's see how these paths move, whether changes in oil prices affect employment, and whether these changes take place in the long run or in the short run. So We found that West Texas Intermediate and the oil and gas and farm sectors, they move together, right, in the long run, but not in the short run. Meaning changes that take place in oil prices in the short run don't really affect farming employment, you know, over the short run. It takes a while before you start to see those effects coming into play. As for manufacturing, construction, and service sectors, West Texas Intermediate does not really influence employment. So that was the study. And then just to cap this, we looked at renewables. And studies have been put out there, and they say that actually the price of the spot price of natural gas has reduced. You know, they move together with oil prices, but it's actually at its lowest period right now, which is really low. So oil prices of natural gas have also decreased, and this is due to the increase in production or increase in supply of natural gas, primarily coming from Marcellus Shale. What about renewables? Many of us would think, well, if oil prices went down, would we see an increase in renewable energy? Would we see people, you know, adopting more renewable energy technologies because oil prices are low? Well, we did the same thing, and we looked at this. Now, this graph is not as clear, but you may be able to see it in the printed material. But natural gas, total renewable energy has actually decreased during this period, but investment in renewables has been quite high, as reports have found. So we're seeing changes here and there, but at the end, this is what we're getting to. So what do we take away? Now, since the turn of the decade, Kern County's population has slowed down. It was growing quite fast, but it has slowed down to roughly the same rate as California. That's population. In terms of GDP, we were moving quite fast. We were growing, but it has also slowed down to Kern County's level, I mean, to California's level. And then while some sectors lost jobs when the oil prices declined, there was a modest increase in employment in Kern County. And then oil prices affect employment, but the effect is not immediate. So those are some of the takeaways. I hope you at least take one of these home, maybe two or three, or all of them. It'll be really nice if you take all of them. Okay. So I'd like to introduce Dr. Gearhart, who is a health economist at California State, at CSUB. And Dr. Gearhart, the Affordable Care Act is a game changer, and it's gobbling more and more GDP. So what changes are we noticing in Kern County's health industry? And is healthcare more affordable? Are people, do you have more people being covered? And how is that affecting jobs?
So to save a little bit of time, I'm going to skip the first slide. It's not as important. If we look at the percent of children who are uninsured, we've decreased from about 1 in 11 children not being uninsured to much less. So children are a low-cost population that we can treat effectively. It's good to get children insured. If we look at the total number of Medi-Cal beneficiaries since 2009, there's been about 150,000 number increase in total Medi-Cal beneficiaries. So that's a huge increase. And unfortunately, what we're seeing is these individuals are either not utilizing care just because of the long wait times to see their family doctors, or in the second column, they're using the emergency department as their primary source of care. So among Medi-Cal patients, there's been a nearly 10% increase in the number of visits by Medi-Cal patients. That's not good. Unfortunately, even though the number of providers, both in hospitals and nurses, has increased in Kern County, since 2009, there's been a nearly 50% increase in the number of nurses, which is more than total employment, so that's really good. It still isn't keeping pace with the total number of Medi-Cal beneficiaries. And so I want to talk a little bit about healthcare efficiency. And we often hear that Kern County is one of the poorest providers of healthcare. And what we hear is that the healthcare inputs, the providers, the doctors, the nurses, the hospitals, the equipment that we utilize, those are the only things that are used to impact individual health. And that's incorrect. There are a lot of other factors that influence population health. They're demographic, the race, gender, your age. They're environmental, your access to clean water, your access to healthy foods, the air quality. Behavioral is huge. Smoking, drinking, those monster energy drinks that fall out of trucks whenever someone steps in. Economic, unemployment, household income. And so the Robert Woods Johnson Foundation creates county health rankings, and they say that Kern County is near dead last in producing healthcare. And we've done a study and said, is Kern County healthcare that bad? And the answer is no. Look at all these factors. Behavioral. We're more likely to smoke, less likely to go to college, less likely to exercise, more likely to have children in poverty, have unclean water, and we have fewer medical providers than California as a whole. Well, if we take a look at the difference in these inputs and some certain health outcomes between us and California, notice the red. We have significantly worse health inputs than health outputs, or our medical providers are fighting an uphill battle from the moment that they see a patient. Basically, healthcare inputs are all significantly much worse in Kern County than in California on average. Healthcare providers are doing a fantastic job providing care that offsets many of these disadvantages that they face. Again, they're fighting an uphill battle. Dr. Macheka and I did a study on this, and we found that Kern County ranks middle of the pack, much better than what previous analyses have found. And we still ask ourselves, is that still low? And the answer is no. Most of the impact of having low health outcomes is behavioral in Kern County. It's the smoking, not exercising, the drinking, eating the fast food. So even though medical providers might be able to provide treatment, health behaviors can offset a lot of the good that our health care can do. Talk very, very briefly on how would a hypothetical minimum wage increase of $15 impact Kern County.
And I noticed in the paper this morning that that will be on the ballot in November.
So, California. Very hypothetical. So, we look in the first column, about 40% of the workforce in Kern County earns less than $15 an hour. Pretty much all cashiers, retail salesmen, fast food and restaurant cooks, servers, and farm workers would be impacted. Or essentially, we estimate that 120,000 people in Kern County of the nearly 300,000 would have to have their wages raised. This doesn't take into account the fact that other workers will have their wages raised just because they feel like they need to. And it's mostly driven by the farm sector. One point to make, and it's very important, is that a federal minimum wage is probably not the best tool to combat poverty. A $15 per hour minimum wage feels like $15.35 in Bakersfield and $12.47 in San Francisco. Our dollar goes a lot further than a lot of other places, signifying that perhaps we should look at county level initiatives if we want to impact poverty. I'll now turn it over to Dr. Mark Evans.
Okay, the United States needs approximately $1.7 trillion of infrastructure by the end of the decade. Now, in a country like Germany or Canada, which is just as committed to environmental quality as the United States, it would take about 2 years to get one of these projects off the ground. Here in the United States, it takes 8 to 10 years to get really the permitting approvals. It's not that Germany is less committed to the environment, it's just that they know how to make a decision. Now, a nonpartisan reform group called Common Good published a study in September that tried to estimate that the cost, in addition to this 1.7 just current capital costs, what are the costs of delaying these projects or this portfolio of projects from, let's say, a 2-year approval rate to an 8? And they found that it would cost actually $3.6 trillion extra in foregone benefits and increased project costs just because of stringing out this process. That's in addition to the $1.7 trillion, just because of the delays themselves. I'm going to skip this chart in the interest of moving on. But there have been several efforts to reform the process, and most of the suggestions focus around four things. One is we need to consolidate authority and make somebody politically accountable. And what that means is the decisions have to be made in terms of scope of environmental review, permitting. Take them out of the judiciary sector and put it somewhere where someone's politically accountable. Secondly, the role of public comment needs to be transformed from blocking and delaying to informing whoever has the political accountability. Third, we need to remove the fact that an EIR may be imperfect as a grounds for litigation, because things can always be made a little bit better if you're just willing to spend enough money. And then finally, we need specific timelines. Now, please skip this slide too, Richard. The slide I just skipped tried to indicate that really Kern County laid the foundation for attacking a lot of these things that need to be reformed nationwide, starting with wind energy in 1986. But let's fast forward to the present, where we recently changed our process for oil permitting. And basically what's happened here is the county really is now involved for the first time in terms of oil permitting. And what they've done is they've structured this permitting in a way that it's completely what's called ministerial, which means that it involves simply a checkoff regarding whether certain standards have been met. And the standards that have to be met are in the EIR that the county put together, and that EIR is structured to where its standards are substantive enough to constitute an adequate environmental document under CEQA. So that has big implications, because if it stands, there's sort of a once and for all look at whether the EIR is appropriate, and then if it is, it applies to oil development throughout the county. Now, from the perspective of these reform goals I mentioned, in terms of timelines, what we've done is we've incentivized negotiating agreements between surface rights holders and mineral rights holders. This should lead to less litigation, and we've also incentivized it by accelerating permit review timelines if you can come up with a negotiated agreement. In terms of reforming the EIR process, you really can't do anything about that at the local level, but it's kind of creative, and that what our county's trying to do is structure that so there will be one EIR challenge rather than an EIR challenge. It's kind of like a meta challenge that we've got to get through. But if that succeeds, then the procedure is in place to basically, you've done the review for everything that's going to happen after that, rather than having to have a challenge each one individually. And then in terms of rationalizing the authority lines, again, we can't do anything about federal law at the national level, but we have put together a process that's streamlined, coordinated, that's really a roadmap that all other state agencies can do in terms of performing their responsibility in the permitting process. So quite entrepreneurial, in my opinion. Now, the reason I'm talking about physical infrastructure and private investment, as well as education, is those really are the two ingredients of future growth. So, you know, I think in terms of capital formation, as long as we have the stewardship that's required to fund these projects, the county is in a really good position in terms of making sure they happen. With regard to human capital, as President Mitchell mentioned, we now are able to actually figure out what individual colleges are doing in terms of either adding value in the workplace of their graduates or not adding value. There have been two very good studies by very reputable organizations recently, and I'd like to summarize them. First, the Brookings Institution did an evaluation of two-year colleges and four-year colleges, and what they came up with in terms of estimate for Bakersfield College is that Bakersfield College, really mid-career, adds 4,000 more in earnings to its graduates than similar graduates graduating from similar colleges in similar regions. This puts BC in the 85th percentile in terms of two-year colleges. So this is really a phenomenal result. Taft College. But 10 years out, a graduate of Taft College is making almost $7,000 a year more than a graduate with the same personal characteristics graduating from a similar college in a similar region. This puts Taft in the 96th percentile in terms of two-year colleges. CSUB, the earnings of our typical grad 10 years down the road are almost $12,000 more than graduates of similar colleges that have similar abilities to our students graduating in regions with similar labor markets. That was the 95th percentile in terms of four-year colleges. Second big study was by The Economist magazine. And The Economist looked only at four-year colleges. And what it found is, this is reassuring, but their estimates were quite close to the Brookings institutions, which suggests that the studies are reliable and that they're coming up with similar estimates. But again, about $11,000 additional earnings over students with the same ability graduating from universities with the same general characteristics. This put us at number 10 in the nation in terms of increase and value added, 99th percentile. Dr. Mitchell told me he's looking forward to another top 10 rating here, one or two marches down the road. At any rate, you know, final reflection, I think our county is really well positioned. I think what we've done is, in terms of the things we can locally can control, we're ready to move forward when oil prices stabilize. Our permitting policies really allow both companies and government to create a decent rate of return by allowing them to implement projects on a timely basis. We saw on the earlier slide that this can make a huge difference in terms of cost and rate of return. Yet the way we've structured this permitting process, we buy the timeliness by really requiring the state-of-the-art environmental protection. So I don't think most people realize that from reading the people that show up at a lot of the public hearings. And then in terms of our universities, they now are really recognized by some very reputable national and international organizations as among the best in the world, or best in the country, I should say. And that's it. Thank you.
Mark and panelists, thank you very much. We appreciate your presentation today. The city of Riverside ranks number one in the nation for growth of the millennial population, according to a recent Pew Research Institute study. We are privileged today to welcome Emilio Ramirez, Deputy Director for the City of Riverside's Community and Economic Development Department. He's going to share what his city is doing to attract and retain this important segment of Riverside's workforce. He has served the City of Riverside since 2011 after 15 years with the Redevelopment Agency and affordable housing experience with the County of Riverside. Emilio received undergraduate degrees from the University of California, Riverside, a graduate degree from Cal Poly Pomona, and a degree of law from Whittier Law School. So please help me in welcoming Emilio Ramirez.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. My name is Emilio Ramirez, as you just heard. I have the distinct privilege of serving the city of Riverside as their director of development and also director of its successor agency and deputy director for community economic development. Very, very honored and privileged that you have invited me to join you from the Inland Empire to the Golden Empire. It's really cool. I've been asked to share a little bit about the city of Riverside and what we are doing to progress and to develop and to try to attract and retain the younger generation as well as maintaining all generations that live in Riverside. I have been doing a little bit of research on the area here in Kern County in Bakersfield, trying to get ready for this. Admittedly, I haven't really stopped in Bakersfield. I grew up in a little area of Marysville, north of Sacramento, and I moved to Riverside, and I've driven by here I don't know how many times, and yet haven't really stopped. So I did a little bit of research. I discovered that we're a lot alike, and that's probably why number one and number two ranking, and I'm not about to try to show you or teach you anything that we've done that I'm sure you guys have already figured out. I'm going to show you a little bit about the City of Arts and Innovation, which is what the City of Riverside likes to believe that it is. I think that we are. And I think that that leads to why there has been some success in what we're talking about today. I can tell you that we had embarked upon a mission in early 2000 to invest about $1.5 billion in the infrastructure in Riverside, calling it the Riverside Renaissance. And it would be disingenuous of me to tell you that we knew that in 2016 it was going to create a center of millennials in downtown Riverside or in Riverside as a whole. But we got lucky, and we're very, very happy about that. I can tell you also that from my research, it appears as though millennials are people too, so that's cool. And we've learned along the way in the United States that change is constant, change is always, and generation from generation, we always have to try to adhere to what the new generation is, and millennials happen to be the new generation and taking up a significant part of the population, both in Riverside and in Bakersfield. And I think a lot like what is in Riverside, millennials, like everything else, they're homegrown. And a lot in Bakersfield as well. I'm gonna go through a little bit of what we are doing in Riverside, and I think that you're gonna see a lot of similarities in what you're doing here and what you're undertaking. I do think that I'm jealous about a couple things that you guys are working on. Your Make Bakersfield Downtown project, I think that's so hot. I wish we could take it, I'm probably gonna steal it. So let me show you a little bit about what Riverside is doing. It's quick, I assure you. First a video. Maybe no video. Thank you.
Thank you. What I love about Riverside is that it's active. It's diverse. There's so many things to do. There are so many choices. But what I like most about Riverside, and something that I learned last night, I got here pretty late and I was having dinner locally, and I was talking to a couple of the waitresses, and we, like you, we're proud of where we come from. We want to stay here. You know, we like it here. And we love the community. We love the neighborhood. We love to engage with one another. We love to experience life together. And I think that that's what brings all generations together, not just millennials. But what we've learned, and I think that we're going to hear again in a little bit from Mr. Jenkins, is that a lot of the today's desires is really the experience, is really the path towards the goal, the path towards the motivation or whatever the cause might be. And I'm going to go through a process to kind of identify things that are occurring in Riverside in a way that continues to allow a significant amount of experiences towards the path to reaching a professional life and family and attaining a cause that we are all after. All the while without having compromised what unique Riverside is. And I think a lot of what you're going to see is a lot what Bakersfield is about as well. You're doing a lot of things, and hopefully you know that there are so many institutions here in Bakersfield that you won't compromise. Bakersfield College, for example, 100-plus year institution, 15,000 students. That's amazing. So on screen is images of four colleges and universities that exist in Riverside. And in Riverside, the student population is just over 57,000 students. And those are the new labor. That's the new people that are going to have jobs in Riverside. And we are continuing to grow and continuing to make an effort to avoid what we have called many years the brain drain coming out of Riverside, and trying to keep them to stay motivated to stay in Riverside. And while they're in school, they're able to experience so many different things. And those different things are not very far apart, but they're very, very different. And they allow for a significant amount of choice and a lot of diversity. The city of Riverside, as part of that $1.5 billion transformation, renovated the Fox Theater, renovated the Municipal Auditorium. Now they're both being run by Live Nation. And as a demonstration of that choice, of that diversity, that provides the experience that we're all after, whether millennial or me, it's available in Riverside. On one day, about 2 years ago, at the Municipal Auditorium, Social Distortion sold out a show, about 2,200 people there. And the same night, Willie Nelson sold out a show at the Fox Theater. Those two things are about two blocks away from each other. Can you imagine the crowd in downtown that night? It was really, really cool. And there was a lot of different people in each of those two shows. And just as an identification that I'm in Riverside, I'm here to study, I'm going to school, I'm going to medical school, I'm going to law school, whatever it is, I'm going to remember that show that I went to, and that's valuable to me, that matters. And I think that that's part of the reason that we're starting to put some headway into turning around the brain drain, turning around the attraction. So we do have some work to go. Riverside does have a very successful downtown pedestrian mall. It's not new. It's been there a long, long time. And along the way, it has transformed. And we, thankfully so, me and everybody at City Hall is responsible enough to know that we don't know everything there is to know. We're hopefully not too arrogant to allow the flexibility to occur, including in the downtown pedestrian mall. There is a lot of culture, there's a lot of performing arts that are on the downtown pedestrian mall, but there's still a lot of opportunity, and that opportunity we're still trying to harness. At the bottom
Right over that picture on the screen right now is a fairly empty surface parking lot that we are working to build. And we're doing that in order to kind of provide for a higher density in downtown, a greater opportunity for living and gathering and experiencing life together. And that project that we're working on that corner, we're talking about almost a third of an acre. And on that third of an acre, we have been able to amend our downtown specific plan to allow for, within the same development, a mixed income housing project of 44 units and an office along the ground floor and a retail function along the opposite ground floor facing Main Street. We're building everything in a way that is about the experience and about being able to live in the unit and have your entire day go to the office and have dinner afterwards at a different project that we are working on, and never having gotten your car. Right, never having left the area that would hopefully end up being a resilient downtown. And that's what we're after. We're after that crowd that can live together, that experience that can be together. And they're young. These pictures are people that live in downtown. I talked to them. I asked them if I can put them on the screen. They were very, very excited. They, much like all of us, are very professional. They're very educated, and they're very ambitious. And they want to, like I do, they want to work and play and have their kids and all of these things all at the same time together. And they want to do that in a way that doesn't limit their opportunity to make decisions as to one day I'm going to do this and the other day I'm going to do that, while at the same time be involved in whatever cause they choose to be involved in. So they move into that apartment complex that we're working on, and they live together in a 2,000 square foot apartment next to a 700 square foot apartment where the rents are compatible but at market based on the different sizes. And there's a mixture, a diversity in the population that lives in there. There's a diversity in the uses that are around it. There's a diversity in the options of those kinds of uses. And after they go to work in downtown, they leave their apartment units, they go work for Best and Krieger, a law firm downtown. And afterwards, they have dinner at the Mess Hall Market that we're working on in downtown. It's right next to the Fox Theater. It's about a block and a half away from that project that I just showed you. And it's just a situation where in that Mess Hall is the Mess Hall's kind of a play on the historic building, the Hess Mall. In that building, there is different vendors where the family can get together. And I skipped the slide. The families can get together and one person have a hamburger over here, another person have sushi over here, get your coffee, get your beer, and sit down together and eat the different things all together at the same time. Like the fact that in downtown, you can do that on a weekday. You'll do it, okay. Thank you. Like the fact that in downtown you can do that on a weekend, on a weekday, and then on a weekend you get up in the morning and still don't have to leave downtown. Downtown is still diverse and is still resilient. There's still education. There's elementary schools downtown. There's a high school. There's a charter performing arts school. There's a culinary school. Everything is there. And you can get a haircut downtown. You can do your grocery shopping downtown. You can entertain family, friends, buy a book, lounge, do your homework, do whatever you got to do all in downtown. And we know that we are all active, myself included. The millennials, they're active people. They still skateboard, some of them. In this area, this resilient downtown that we are working on, hopefully they will be able to still not have to get in their car. They can go for a run and go on the skateboard and actually play golf. There's a golf course that's about a mile away, which I walk to all the time. And this happens, and still you have not got into the car, and you're living and surviving within that resilient downtown, that community, which is growing and growing every single day. So after you had your breakfast and after you went on your run and you went to dinner, there is a myriad of festivals that occur in the downtown pedestrian mall, I think once a week. I can tell you as a city employee, sometimes I have a hard decision trying to figure out which one I'm gonna go to, and I end up going to somewhere else. The Festival of Lights, I don't know if you've heard of the Festival of Lights at the Mission Inn, just an amazing show. Arts Walk every Thursday, Pub Crawl every Monday, the Lunar Festival, just the list goes on and on and on. And like I mentioned, a significant part of the experience is the path or a journey to the cause. And whatever that cause may be, whether you're a developer or a bureaucrat like me, or a lawyer and that's what you trained and that's what you're good at, you have a family and you're doing all of those things and you're on your way, and along the way you're experiencing the diversity of choice in where to eat and where to entertain and where to play and all of those things. But there are so many causes in Riverside that causes that allows people to be passionate about. And that passion has turned into many, many different sections of Riverside that come together, that are involved politically, that are involved with the city, that are involved with their neighbors. Home Front to Campanza, for example, is a project which is a dream project that I worked on. I can't even believe that I had the opportunity to do so. In Riverside, there's a community, a former military base in Riverside called Arlanza. And in Arlanza, there was this building that was boarded up. It was the former officers club of that military compound, and it was boarded up. The city bought it and converted it, rehabbed it, renovated the historic building, converted it to 30 units of affordable housing for family reunification of homeless veterans that are disabled with kids and children. It just opened, and thank you. It just opened about 2 weeks ago. We're planning the ribbon cutting, but the point in that is that project created this buzz amongst many different people that have so many different passions. People that are passionate about veterans, that are passionate about homelessness, affordable housing, historic preservation, neighborhood. Everybody came out and worked together because of that desire to be involved in the transformation. I often have said that those things are, I think, what causes Riverside to be at that brink of maturing into urbanity. I've said that so many times, I'm kind of tired of saying it. So we're right there, and in that regard, it's like Riverside is its own little millennial. It's active, it's changing. It's every time we think of something new, there's always a lot of initiatives, and everybody in town gets involved. I want to be involved in that. I want to change it to this other thing. The Eastside Heal Zone is an effort that we're working on in a community in Riverside. It's called the Eastside. The community is called the Eastside. And it's the idea that a neighborhood and the livability of that neighborhood is really what causes the perception or the feeling of poverty versus the actual income of the person, of the family, where if the neighborhood lives well and it's the housing stock is in good condition and then the parks are playable and all of those things, that is what causes a person to live comfortably in the day of the life of that family. It's the livability of his day, of their day, versus the income. I know that Riverside and Bakersfield, we have similar demographics. Your median income is a little higher than ours. Our poverty rate is a little higher than yours. But they're right there. Ours is 54,000, yours is 53. Ours is about 19, ours is about 19.8% poverty. But this has changed that community, that Eastside community, which is a very, very poor area in Riverside, has changed that community and has transformed it because we want to be involved, because of that passion, and because we feel as though we're not too arrogant to believe that the innovation is going to occur and someone else has to do it, and not just necessarily the City Hall. So that's my presentation. If you have any questions, my contact information is on screen. I'd be happy to share with anything, or if you want to come to Riverside, I'm very, very happy to host you anytime that you want to come by. Thank you.
Emilio, thank you very much for that. I'd like to welcome Summit partner Nick Ortiz, President and CEO of the Greater Bakersfield Chamber of Commerce, to the podium to introduce today's keynote speaker. Nick, thanks for coming today.
Good morning, and sorry for the delay. I walked from the extreme back of the room. We wanted to make sure everybody who actually paid for a ticket got the best seats in the house this morning. I wanted to start by saying, maybe in true millennial fashion, I said this last night, they saved the best partner for last, because millennials, it's all about us, it's all about me. And I know Laura Weiner, who's our consultant who helps us plan this, is making sure that I stay on time. So unlike Richard Chapman, I won't talk about new wave music or French poetry or any other things that he likes to talk about when he takes the podium. First off, and seriously, I want to express my extreme gratitude for our sponsors, our platinum sponsor, Dignity Health, and all of our gold and silver sponsors, all of you who bought a ticket or bought a table today. We appreciate you investing in this event and making it better each year. I also want to thank and just congratulate our partners, KEDC and CSUB, organizations that, along with the Chamber, are really dedicated to growing our economy and providing the workforce for the future. And I think from the programs and some of the presentations we've heard, we have got a lot to be proud of. We've got a lot to be optimistic about. The committee from all three organizations planning this conference has been meeting since the fall, and I think we are all very excited about this year's theme. And it's particularly interesting to me. We participate through the Bakersfield Chamber in a number of industry groups and trade associations, and yes, even trade associations have trade associations, around the issue of millennials and how chambers and membership organizations can reach them, can communicate with them, and can make our organizations relevant to them. In fact, in the chamber industry, I can say millions of man hours and millions of dollars has literally gone into research about how we can do a better job and how we create organizations that remain relevant in the future. And so some of our colleagues in the Western region will look at me or look at some of my other younger colleagues and executives and ask, so what do we do? What do they want? And I, of course, look at them very smugly, very self-assuredly, and say, well, I'm a millennial, and half of my staff are millennials. And then I say, we don't even know. We don't even know what they want. But that's half in jest. But it also speaks, I think, to a broader truth, a truth for the chamber, a truth for KEDC, about organizations that rely on investment and volunteerism and membership in order to do good in our community and drive the economy. How can we be relevant? So Richard started out the summit by referencing Ray Dezember and his recent passing. And as we all know, Ray was a driving force in the business industry and in the chamber and in the creation of KEDC, organizations that still thrive today and carry on, I think, a great legacy. His passing, combined with our theme today, has required me to reflect and ask not only who will be the next generation of business leadership in Bakersfield and Kern County, but also what kind of Bakersfield and Kern County do they want to build? So this is a question and a conversation that is obviously going to last longer than the summit. I hope everyone has come away with a deeper understanding of some of these issues we put in front of you. And I really think that our keynoter, Ryan Jenkins, is going to give us a really good information about these generational challenges we face. So Ryan is an internationally recognized millennial keynote speaker and author. He helps organizations and leaders gain clarity around the millennial generation so that they can effectively lead, communicate, and brand in tomorrow's multi-generational marketplace. Based in Atlanta, Ryan runs a blog and podcast at nextgenerationcatalyst.com. He has been featured in Inc. magazine, Forbes, Fast Company, Mashable, and Yahoo. And I'd like you to help me welcome him to the stage today. Ryan Jenkins.
Good
All right, good morning.
Good morning.
How we doing?
Good.
Yes, it is still morning, if you can believe it. All right, we're gonna kick things off with a quick word association exercise. I'm gonna flash a phrase up on the screen, and when you see that phrase, I want you to shout out, unfiltered, shout it out. Shout out the first word that pops in your mind, all right? So what is the first word that comes to mind when you hear today's generations? Lazy. Well, that didn't take long. Boy, you had that one ready. What else?
Unknown.
Unknown? Interesting. What else?
Innovative.
Entitled. Everyone at once? Entitled, yeah. Innovative. I like that. You and I are going to be friends. Immediate gratification. Risky. Clueless. The best. All right. I think that's my CSUB students in the house, I think.
Next to the best.
Next to the best. I think we covered all of them, right? Hopefully. Now, I have to be honest, I pulled a fast one on you. But don't beat yourself up. This happens every time I do this short, simple little exercise. And I didn't say anything about millennials, did I? I didn't say anything about Generation Z. But that, I think, at least all the responses I heard were geared towards the millennials. And I think why that happens every single time that I've done this exercise is that the most tension surrounds this generation. The most question marks surround the millennial generation. And so that's why I'm here today. That's why the theme of today is really the next generation of millennials. And so that's what we're going to talk about today. Specifically, we're going to talk about next generation engagement, how you can truly engage and leverage this generation in your organizations, your community, on your teams. And I hope to have time for a couple questions. If we don't get there, my email is up on that slide, rj@ryan-jenkins.com. And then all of today's slides that you're about to see are going to be available at that link at the bottom of that slide, ryan-jenkins.com/KES. And I just checked right before I came up here, and my site has actually crashed for the second time ever. I like to think that's because my latest Instagram pic went viral just a few minutes ago. I'd like to think that. So hopefully by the end of today, that it'll be back up in the next hour, and you guys can engage there. But just know you don't have to take pictures of these slides. Don't try to jot everything down. It's all going to be there for you for free, as long as the internet is turned on as well, which is an important thing. Okay, actually, a couple of things before I go into the agenda, and that is, this is going to shock you. It shocks every audience I ever tell this to, but I think it's 100% true. And that is this. I don't want you to listen to anything that I say. You go, wait a minute, you're the guy with the mic and the clicker, the intro. Very true. Don't listen to what I say, listen to what you hear. I think those are drastic different things. And I think you can apply this methodology to any learning environment. Because we're all from different parts of the country at one point. We're all from different generations. We all have unique situations, diverse teams, diverse situations. So not all of this is going to fit neatly into a box, but there are going to be certain things today, two or three things, I hope, that resonate with you in your unique situation. And there are going to be things that you resist as well. But those are all fertile ground for you to pinpoint and drive some depth into and start unpacking so you can move your organizations forward. Second thing I'll say, one of my favorite quotes is by Oliver Holmes, who said, "A mind once stretched never regains its original dimensions." A mind once stretched never regains its original dimensions. And so that's my goal. When you leave the session today, I want you thinking differently about the future. I want you thinking differently about the emerging generations. And so it's safe to say I'm going to put some stretch marks on your brain, okay? Hope you're okay with that. And the last thing before I move on, and that is this. If at any point during today's session, if you just see me fall on my face right in front of you and seem to be lifeless up here, don't panic. No need to panic. It's more than likely it's just because it's been over 30 minutes since I've texted or tweeted. So bear with me. Front row, just come up and like rub a mobile device on me and I'll be fine. Because I am a millennial, if you didn't gather that from my super swag and extra informal attire, I am a millennial. So bear with me. All right, let's jump into the content. Here's where we're going. We're going to talk about millennials. We're going to touch a little bit on Generation Z. And then we're going to talk about some of the generational differences that exist. And then I'm going to give you four elements, four examples, and four strategies to think about with your teams and organizations. All right, so here's a quick snapshot of the generations. Robin did a tremendous job on giving us some really good context, so we're just going to build upon what she shared. And you'll see in the middle there, this chart, and these generations are done by age. And again, the age, depending on what study you look at, they're all a little different. So it's important that we consider generations as clues and not boxes. All right, and in my opinion, they're big clues, very big clues, on how we sell, engage, lead, and communicate across generations. On the right side there, you'll see that's how large the US generations were at their peak. You'll notice a couple asterisks there in the bottom right. That's simply because these generations, unfortunately, aren't that large just from folks passing away. So I want to give you a little context on why generations are so important today, why it's such a relevant conversation. And I want to illustrate that by asking a question. So shout out the answer if you think you know it. What was the average life expectancy of humans in 1902? 42? 40? I don't hear a lot of 40s. 47? 48? 38. Whoa, we're just losing a lot of confidence in the human race. 47 was the correct answer. That was the average life expectancy in 1902. Any guesses what it is today? 100 now, okay, we got some, a lot of confidence, I love it. I'm hearing a lot of 70s, 60s, 85, you guys are, I like this, you guys have a lot of confidence in the 78, that's really close. In the US, it is 79 years old, is the current life expectancy. And to melt your minds even more, they now say that the first person to ever celebrate their 150th birthday has already been born today. Imagine what it looks like to have a midlife crisis at the age of 75. I can't even wrap my head around that. What does that look like? So here's why that's important. I'll give you some context. In over 100 years, we extended the life expectancy, at least in the US, about 32 years. It's pretty extraordinary. And so as medicine advances, as technology advances, we will be living longer. And so not only are we interacting with five generations in the workplace, but it's very possible, very feasible, that in the very near future, we'll be interacting with six, seven, eight, God forbid, nine different generations. So this is a very relevant topic, and it's only going to intensify. It's only going to accelerate. So I think that's why it's very important that we find our footing now. All right, so that gives us a good basis of where we are with the generations. Let's keep moving forward. Let's look at the 2016 workplace. This is the current makeup. You'll notice that Generation Z is now inching into the workplace. And that's mostly in the form of internships. Again, this is a very ambitious bunch. A lot of them are having internships in high school even. But here's what's important about 2015 and 2016. This was really the first year that millennials now outnumber both Gen X and boomers in the workplace. That's why we had all those interesting dynamic and interesting words that came to your mind, right? Because they're challenging a lot of what's already been existing for how many years in the workplace. What's your best guess, and shout it out if you know the answer, what percentage of the workplace will be millennials and Generation Z for a little bit of by 2025? What percentage? Shout it out. 45. 75. I think that was Robin. I heard 75. She's all over this. So that's the correct answer, 75%. Cue the jaw drop. Cue the eye roll. Go ahead. And sometimes I like to barricade the exits, too, before I show that stat, so no one goes running out of the room screaming for their lives. But imagine, think about your situation and the way you work. I bet just 5 years ago, it's drastically different, right, than how you work today. So fast forward 10 years, right, just a little bit under 10 years. Imagine how your work and your industry is going to change when 75% of it are digital natives that think differently and approach the world in a completely different way. There's going to be massive amounts of change. But don't panic. My name is Ryan. I'm your friend. I'm here to help, okay? All right. Give you a couple of millennial stats that can paint the picture, give you some context around this generation. 63% of millennials have a bachelor's degree, making them the most educated generation ever. Now, that doesn't say the most smartest generation. Simply says the most educated. So for my millennials in the room, those that are currently enrolled at a university, it's a very crowded talent pool. What are you doing to rise above? 71% of millennials are disengaged at work, the most of any generation. And I'm going to give you some specific tactics on how to gobble up and erode that statistic in your specific organizations. 58% of millennials expect to leave their jobs in 3 years or less. Now, that number says that they expect to leave in 3 years or less. Does anyone want to venture a guess what the average tenure of a millennial is currently? Did someone say 6 months? Oh, I'm sorry for that. 3 years? Yeah, it's 2 years is the going rate at this point. There's some new research now coming out that's saying it's as short as 16 months. The dynamic has changed, and as one of our panelists mentioned, it's costly, $25,000 to $30,000 to replace a millennial employee. Ouch, right? So again, I'm going to give you some statistics to hopefully to attack that. And then lastly, 70% of millennials across the globe might reject traditional work to traditional business to work independently. So not only, if you're an organization that's looking to recruit top talent, not only are you having to compete against your competitors to pluck that ripe millennial talent, but you're now actually having to compete against the millennials' own ambition to be an entrepreneur. And as we've seen, it's easier than ever before to be an entrepreneur, isn't it? The barriers are lower than ever before. You can go to a Starbucks, launch a business, and market it to the world via social media before lunchtime. And think about this too. Entrepreneurship wasn't always sexy. There was a time where if you were an entrepreneur and you told someone you were an entrepreneur, someone would roll their eyes in the back of their head. They'd be saying, "That means you don't have the skills to get a corporate job." Right? That's true. It's now sexy to be an entrepreneur, and a lot of millennials have a side hustle while they're still at school. So this is something that we have to lean into, and I'll give you a specific tactic on how to attack that statistic as well. All right, I think this is really important to put some context around as well, is millennials and Generation Z are truly the first global generations. 50% of millennials want opportunities for international work assignments. And 58% of adults worldwide, ages 35 and above, agree that kids today have more in common with their global peers than they do with adults in their own country. So what does that mean? An 8-year-old here in Bakersfield, California, could have more in common with an 8-year-old in India than someone who's 65 in their own country. It's a global generation. We'll talk about how they became that way. I'm fortunate enough to write for, I have a column for Inc.com, and the stuff that I write about that's mostly US-based, you can find same content, same ideas in the Moscow Times. So we live now in a very connected world, and this generation grew up in a very connected world, and we'll talk specifically about that. All right, so we're going to have some fun with this now. We're going to talk about the evolution of the millennials, okay? We're going to take one millennial's story, and we're going to call this individual Millennial Mike, and his story starts in 1988. And he was born. He was one in a million, literally. And we're going to fast forward to when things get a little interesting, and that is in the year 1996. Millennial Mike is infatuated with Nintendo, specifically Nintendo 64. Some of you are chuckling because this might be your son or daughter. And so gaming fundamentally has rewired this generation. This is a generation that grew up gaming. Gaming is exploding. 97% of youth today play computer or video games. It's no longer something weird that you do in the basement of your mom's house, right? Gaming is exploding. Wait and see. You'll see much more esports, which are, you know, gamified sports, on a lot of channels in the very near future. But here's why gaming is important. Here's the first takeaway. Millennials desire feedback, difference making, and diverse teamwork. So let's tackle the first one. They desire feedback. Well, they grew up gaming, right? And what is gaming? Well, gaming is a constant feedback loop. You push a button, something happens. You choose this mission, something happens. And so you're in this environment where you're constantly receiving feedback. So that's an expectation they now pull into the workplace, and they expect constant feedback. Robin alluded to it earlier, and it's very true. Secondly, they want to be difference makers. That's why we play games. They immerse themselves in games to save the world, to have that epic win. They now pull that into the workplace. They want to have an impact on day one, right? Some of you probably felt this tension. And then lastly, they want diverse teamwork. Millennial Mike was able to jump on Xbox, put on a headset, and play along somebody in real time that was halfway around the globe. So again, this has helped shape the thinking of this generation that they're really boundaryless, right? So that's our first takeaway. Now let's fast forward to the year 2000. Millennial Mike is in middle school, and he hears about this thing called AOL. Thinks that sounds kind of cool. Him and his buddies go home after school. They jump online. About an hour later, they're able to create their username. Yep. Thank you, dial-up. And they begin chatting with friends, and they're leaning into technology and testing and figuring it out and pushing the envelope. Here's what we learned from this phase in Millennial Mike's life. I'm sorry, my clicker is losing a little bit of gas, I think. Maybe I forgot to work out this morning. Millennials number two, or takeaway number two, millennials approach differently how they learn, work, socialize, communicate, play because of technology. It's fundamentally rewired their brain. All right, now let's move forward to the year 2003. This is where things get really interesting. Millennial Mike is in high school, and he has access to Google. How many of you had access to Google while in high school? Throw your hand up. All straight-A students, I imagine, yes? Can I get a head nod? No? Okay, so let's all play along. What if we had access to Google in high school? What if we all did that? What would we have done? Shout it out. Not gone to the library. What else?
I would have started Facebook.
You would have started Facebook. And with that kind of gumption and ambition, I know you would have. I like that. What else?
Plagiarizing.
Shopped. Someone said shop. I love that, of course. Yeah, we would have all gotten really good at cutting and pasting, right? Cut, paste, cut, paste. I asked this question about a month ago in another session with an organization. A gal in the front row, it was just a knee-jerk reaction as soon as I asked that question. She jumped out of her seat and said, I would have cheated better. And everyone slowly nodded like, that's what we were thinking, but no one said it. And I loved it too that she was in the front row and said that. It was brilliant. Yeah, so here's what's really important. Again, access to the internet, technology has shaped this generation. And the millennials are the first generation ever to not consider teachers or parents as the authority, but rather who or what do they consider the authority? Themselves, I heard someone say. The internet, right? You got the world's information at your fingertips, you better believe you're gonna use it. So here's what we learned. Millennials consider the internet the authority, and they thus think and approach problems fundamentally different, fundamentally. We'll move now to the year 2005. Millennial Mike is finally able to join Facebook. And I say finally because there was tons of buzz at the moment around the idea of Facebook. And Facebook started in 2004. It was college only. 2005, it opened up to high school. And so you better believe Millennial Mike jumped all over it, started a group, began connecting with other students that were about to attend his college, and he made friends, even found a roommate before he even set foot on college campus. So they were using it as a tool. Also in 2005, Millennial Mike, he's about to go to college, he's a senior, his parents decide him to give him what? A cell phone. Decide to give him a cell phone. And for you parents in the room that gave your child a cell phone, it was for two reasons. For safety and logistics, right? But you immediately regretted that decision. Immediately when you received that first bill, didn't you? We're all chuckling because it's true. Why did you freak out when you got that bill? Texting, right? I heard a few of you say it, texting. Millennial Mike discovered texting, and that charges were skyrocketing. So here's what we learned from this phase in Millennial Mike's life. there it is. I'm just keeping you guys in suspense here. Millennials, takeaway number four, are early adopters and seek out opportunities to innovate. When it came to social media, Google, instant messaging, texting, mobile devices, they're early. So they pull that now expectation of the workplace, and they're looking to innovate. They're going to push the boundaries. They're going to see how they can work smarter, systemize, or create systems, automate things. Let's move forward now to the year 2007. Millennial Mike is in college, and he is fortunate enough to have parents that buy him what iconic device? The iPhone. You bet. Now, the iPhone, first of all, I don't think we give the iPhone enough credit for how much it's just changed everything, right? It's changed the game. But for millennials, this thing was nirvana. They were already texting, right? And the iPhone introduced its first virtual keyboard. It introduced predictive text technology. It could learn new words. And the saving grace of the entire millennial generation, automatic spell check. How would we have survived without it? So it's changed the game, and I think really because of all those features I just rattled off, and with the millennials, the largest generation on the planet, I really think they moved the needle. And here in 2007, when the iPhone came out, was fundamental for all of us, all Americans in the room, each and every one of you. 2007 was the first year we sent and received more text messages than we did phone calls. Fundamentally changed our behavior. I'm going to have a little fun here, if I can. Raise your hand if the last communication you had was a phone call. You actually spoke to someone on the other end of a phone. Raise your hand if that was your last piece of communication. I see maybe 10 of you in a room of 500. Our behaviors have changed. I'm not going to even say this is necessarily a generational thing. We are all experiencing change, and I'm going to talk about that in a few. But all this technology is impacting the way we communicate, the way we work, the way we live. So here's the takeaway. Millennials' communication has and will continue to be shaped by technology. 2008, Millennial Mike is still in college, and he bumps into this thing called Twitter. He thinks, man, this looks like a shiny AOL. So he creates an account, starts using Twitter. And in the early stages, Twitter was really considered a microblog where people could just share thoughts and ideas. And what that opened Millennials Mike's eyes to the world of blogging. And so he began blogging, and he used Tumblr, which was a very millennial-friendly blogging platform. And he began sharing his thoughts, ideas, opinions, what have you. And now 50% of all bloggers today are millennials. And here's what we learned from this pivotal point in Millennial Mike's life. Millennials are contributors looking for an active role and an immediate impact. The internet has given them a global platform to have a voice and to contribute, and they've taken advantage of it. And they pull that into the workplace. On day one, they want to have an impact. On day one, they might send you an email with a list of all the things that are wrong with your organization, right? All right. 2009, Millennial Mike is a senior in college, and he's about to graduate. Who does that anymore in 4 years? So he's about to graduate. Before he gets a job, what's he have to do? Shout it out. Resume, network, all right answers, LinkedIn. I think before any of that, Millennial Mike has got to go to Facebook, and he's got to de-tag himself from all his spring break photos. That is priority number one, right? But we laugh at that because it's true. But we laugh at it because millennials had no idea. They were the first on Facebook, and they were using it just to hang out with friends and to connect and communicate. They had no idea employers were going to use it to vet them as their character or use that as their personal brand. So very interesting. I also want to say that it's really interesting now how behaviors are rippling up. I think it's really one of the first times, I think, in a long time, or perhaps ever, how quickly behaviors are rippling up the generations. All right, Facebook, I won't do this to this crowd, because I like you, and I'm your friend. But sometimes, if I'm feeling ornery, I'll ask a crowd, raise your hand if you're on Facebook right now. The whole room pretty much raises their hand. And then I ask them, keep your hand raised if you've ever told yourself or someone else that you would never be on Facebook. And most of that room keeps their hand shamefully raised. So I think we're at a point in how turbulent things are that we need to be careful to be so judgmental or criticize some of these new forms of communication, because we might just be using that same communication in the very new future, especially as these millennials move into the workplace. So my point here, millennials are massively persuaded by their peers and value relationships and experiences over work. Millennial Mike, as he's getting ready to find a job, he's amassed large social networks, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, and he's going to lean into those networks to crowdsource his life decisions. He's going to ask those networks, what book should I read? Where should I go eat? What movie should I see? What city should I go live in? And really, last on that list is, where should I go work? Millennials still typically choose a city before they actually choose a job. Because again, they value relationships and experiences over work. So if you're trying to connect with this generation, leverage their peers. All right, moving forward. And keeping everyone in suspense. 2012. Millennial Mike is now settling in, or he's been in his career for 3 years, and he's got three different careers, right? Seems about right for millennials. Job hopping, seeing what's going on, what's out there. But here's the dynamics that are at play here. How many of you are familiar with Glassdoor, the website Glassdoor? Good, enough of, you know, a good portion of you. Glassdoor, for those that don't know, it's a website that houses employee reviews on their companies, what benefits those companies offer, salaries. It's created tremendous job market transparency. And so now millennials, you can't pull any wool over their eyes. They can actually see what's going on in other organizations. And layer on top of that, Facebook and YouTube, they know exactly what they're missing in other organizations. And so now it's putting new accountability on organizations to make some really dynamic culture changes. So what we learned from this, millennials' takeaway number 8 is they demand transparency from their leaders, their employers, and their brands. That's kind of been a theme that you've heard throughout the day, that they value authenticity. 2014, Millennial Mike is now settling in as a young professional, and technology continues to shape how he lives, works, and play. Specifically, we look at Netflix and Amazon. That's created an on-demand generation. I have an 8-month-old daughter, and she will not know a world where she can't hit a button and a drone will drop off a package within an hour. So that's going to reshape how she thinks about shopping, right? So I think there's lots of dynamics at play, especially when we talk about an on-demand generation. Snapchat. How many of you are on Snapchat? Be proud. Yeah, all right. I know where the student table is now. Snapchat. If you want to connect with this generation, you're trying to market this generation, you should be seriously considering Snapchat. A majority of millennials are using Snapchat. It's got the same momentum as a Facebook or Twitter. It's the fastest growing social network today. And you'd be kidding yourself if you think this emerging generations, as they come into the workplace and as they're fundamentally communicating different via Snapchat, that they're gonna be okay communicating just via email. They're gonna fundamentally challenge how we communicate in the workplace because they're already communicating in a much different way. Uber and Airbnb has created a love of the share economy for this generation. And then lastly, Slack. How many of you are familiar with the company and the tool Slack? Only a few of you. Slack is, Inc.com just rated Slack as their company of the year. It's one of the fastest growing tech companies in the last decade or two. If we can get those slides back up, my AV team. Slack is one of the fastest growing technology companies out there. And what is Slack? It's an app messaging tool. So it's basically a hybrid of Twitter and email, if you will. And so why it's so powerful is this, again, this generation wants to collaborate. They want to use collaborative technologies to communicate, and they're flocking to Slack. And we'll talk a little bit about it later. But here's what else is really incredible about Slack. I think some of you are probably on your devices trying to figure out to download this right now, right? The number one goal for Slack, the organization and the tool, is to eradicate email. Can I get an amen? Right? So again, these technologies are shaping how this generation, how they communicate, how they approach work. And so they're going to continue to lean into these technologies. All right, and then lastly, in Millennial Mike's journey, 2016, he is now getting ready to step into his first management role. I got a couple chuckles. Okay, yeah, because it's scary, I imagine, right? In fact, 30% of 21 to 32-year-olds have already achieved a management position. So the takeaway here, what I want to ask you is, before I ask you a question, is millennials, high-tech and hyper-social upbringing have made them disruption-prone leaders. How will millennials change your world? How will Millennial Mike, in this high-tech, hyper-social upbringing that he's had, how will that impact your industry? How is that going to impact how you work? especially as they begin making decisions in organizations. And I promise you, please hear me when I say this, I promise you, millennials are not trying to aggravate you on purpose. I promise. They have just a fundamentally different background, right? They've grown up, I mean, none of us have ever seen this before. So it has created a new breed of worker, a new breed of consumer. And so we have to start understanding it. And why I think it's so important to look at generations is that there's behavior. So you can pinpoint it, understand it, begin predicting how do I adjust my leadership, my communication, my business, my brand. So the question is, will you be ready when this generation begins stepping into the workplace into decision-making roles? Will you be ready? What's going to happen? My gut says massive amounts of change. But don't panic. Again, my name is Ryan. I'm here to help, okay? So I'm going to give you some actionable strategies here in a few. But if I know we camped out here a lot, but I hope it's really helpful. Again, you guys can have all these slides. But if you don't, if you haven't heard anything else that I say so far, get this one thing. This is really important as well. Nintendo is to blame for everything. We now know. All right, so here's just a cheat sheet. Again, this is a tool that's also going to be on that link whenever it's back live. And again, you can just have that. That's everything we just talked about. So use this, and hopefully it'll impact your organization, your leadership. All right, let's talk a little bit about Generation Z. Let's just kind of touch the surface, because they're still pretty young. We don't know a whole lot about them. 73% of Generation Z are connected within an hour or less of waking up. I think it's maybe when I walk over there that the clicker is. Over 50% of Generation Z say it's easier or more convenient to chat digitally. 77% of Generation Z rely on technology to help accomplish personal and professional goals. And lastly, 65% say people whom they work with would enable their work. So again, this is to just help you get some context around who this generation is. So let's look at what are the difference between millennials and Gen Z. So Generation Z, I believe, is going to be more pragmatic. They grew up in a very turbulent time, terrorism, war, recession. And they're looking at the millennials. They got a front row seat to the millennials and a lot of their shortcomings, and so they're going to adjust. The millennials are super optimistic and hopeful, like Robin mentioned, but I think this generation will be much more realistic and pragmatic. Oh, before I go there, more individualistic. Generation Z grew up in a world that was connected. Their parents were posting pictures of their sonogram before they were even born. So a lot of them have a digital footprint before they're even in this world. And so a lot of them are going to look to peel away and begin developing their own individualism or individualistic traits, because to them it seems like everyone's done everything and they've already kind of built their social footprint on the web. So we expect them to find more individual ways to express themselves. More face-to-face. This might surprise many of you. But again, millennials had, or Generation Z had a front row seat into what many would say is perhaps the Achilles heel of a millennials, which is lack of interpersonal skills and the ability to communicate face to face. So I think they're going to counterbalance that. They're going to focus on that. But also look at the tools they're using. Snapchat, FaceTime, Google Plus Hangouts, Skype. They're actually communicating face to face. Where it might not be in person, it's virtual, and they're using motion, sound, and visual to communicate. So I see a resurgence in the face-to-face communication. I think we can all be excited about that. More global. As more of the world comes online, it's going to shrink geographies. The world will become flatter, smaller, essentially. And so, of course, this generation is going to think more boundaryless than the millennials. They're going to have global thought process and global relatability and global communication skills. They're going to be less focused. There's more clamoring for their attention than ever before. They have 10-second Snapchats. They have 6-second Vines. They're consuming this information on a rapid pace. So we anticipate they'll be less focused than millennials. They'll be less parented. Generation X are the folks that are raising this generation, Generation Z for the most part. And Generation X is very aware of the stigma and perhaps the negativity surrounding that everyone gets a trophy parenting style that the millennials had from the baby boomers. So they're gonna actually consider themselves a coach versus a friend when it comes to parenting. And then they're gonna be less educated. You think about Generation Z, actually statistics show that they're not looking to pursue higher education as much as the millennials were at the same age? And why would they when there's so many alternatives out there, right? So they're constantly figuring this. We heard it from Chris, too, when you hear about the student loan debt. So they're evaluating these things in their head. So I would say they might be less formally educated because they're going to leverage the web to learn some things and more on the fly in the workplace as well. And then lastly, they may be less noticed. Generation X, Chris was shouting it out. He was trying to give you guys some love. Why? Because you were overshadowed by the large baby boom generation. So that very well could happen to Generation Z as well, being overshadowed from the largest generation on the planet, the millennials. All right, this is the last slide before we dig into our next topic and look at, and before I start giving you some strategies. This is really important though. Millennials are a critical mass of change agents. What is critical mass? If you have a scale and you finally have enough of something that tips that scale, that's critical mass, okay? And why are millennials critical mass? Because they're the largest generation on the planet. Where they go, so goes change. Where they go, so goes disruption. Social media is a good example. It was created by a millennial, AKA Mark Zuckerberg, for the most part. It was adopted by millennials, and now it's gone mainstreamed because of millennials. And people always ask me, well, Ryan, why is today different? There's always been generational differences when they come into the workplace. Boomers, when you came into the workplace, massive amounts of change because of your sheer size, right? Here's why today's different, though, and here's why we've got to find our footing. Two reasons why today's different: technology and the internet. Technology and the internet have changed the game. It's changed how we live and work, hasn't it? It's changed the game. And so you have those two items, and you couple it with the largest generation on the planet, and that's the recipe for massive, massive disruption. We're living in exponential times. I want to tell you a little bit about what are these, and what does it look like to live in an exponential time. And I want to do that with a question. So I'm going to ask you, and shout out whatever comes to your mind. Name an invention that's happened in the past, and we can go back as far as fire if you guys want. So just shout out an invention that's happened in the past. The wheel, electricity, the printing press, airplanes, the light bulb. Yeah, what else? Computers. I think we're almost there. I think we have two left. We could basically name anything in this room. Light bulbs, you know, stage, monitors, TVs, right? It's incredible how far we've come. But here's what's important. Here's why today's different. All those inventions that I heard and that I repeated are all inventions that have impacted our physical world. So that has limited how much growth they have. It's limited how fast other people can adopt it, right? Well, today's inventions are happening in the cloud, a lot of them. They're happening in cyberspace, in the digital world. So that's giving it power to grow exponentially. So let me give you a good example, or a couple of examples. If Facebook, you know, it was really an invention that happened in the cloud, right? If Facebook was a country, where would it rank based on population in the world? I think I heard biggest, yes. It would be number one based on population. 1.5 billion people use Facebook. And in August of last year, Facebook, for the first time ever, reached a pretty astonishing statistic, and that was 1 billion people used Facebook in a single day. 1 billion people used Facebook in a single day. That could not have happened in any other time in history where that many people can use a single tool. And guess what? Facebook started in 2004. It's the biggest country based on population on the planet. Exponential times that we live in. The mobile device that some of you clearly are playing Candy Crush on right now. Yeah, I see you. This mobile device, again, we don't give enough credit. This mobile device is one, all of you that have them in your hand, your purse, your pocket, this device is 100,000 times smaller and several billion, with a B, several billion times more powerful than a computer was in the early 70s. We carry this around with us. Pretty unbelievable, right? And if you took this device and you gave it to a child in a developing country, they would instantly have access to more information than the president of the United States did just 15 years ago. Exponential times that we're living in. A couple more examples to further melt your minds. What's the largest taxi service on the planet today? Uber. And how many does Uber doesn't own any what? Taxis, cars, vehicles. Yeah. And by the way, Uber is the largest taxi service on the planet, and they'll be celebrating their 7th birthday this year. What's the largest hotel service on the planet? Airbnb. The second largest hotel service is Marriott. They have 1 million rooms available around the world. Marriott's number two with 1 million rooms. They've been around for over 55 years. Airbnb has been around 8 years and has 2 million rooms. Exponential times that we live in. And oh, by the way, they don't own a single room, right? So we live in exponential times. So I say all that because it's really important that we understand that it's not just generational. This isn't just a millennial thing. All of us are living through a fundamental culture shifts that's changing everything. And so we have to be aware of it. And so yes, the millennials are demanding a lot of change from us and our organizations, but more importantly, in a bigger picture, is the exponential times that we now live in are forcing us to change. If we don't get smart, if we don't get agile, we'll be past at the speed of Uber, right? Really important. And so that's why I think it's important, again, to look at millennials, because they're a signpost of all this change. They give us some behavior behind some of this change. And so that's why I think there's tremendous value to understand them and to even poke fun at them a little bit, right? Okay, that was a lot. We'll all take a deep breath now, all right? But I knew you guys could handle it, okay? All right, so now let's talk a little bit about some of the generational differences, and then I'll get into those four strategies to help. So we're going to look at four generations that are in the workplace, and we're going to look at their communication preferences. Robin touched on a lot of this as well, so I'll step through it a little bit quicker. When it comes to communication, the builders look for formal, respectful. Boomers want formal, direct. Gen X want informal, flexible. And millennials want informal, authentic. Their view of communication, builders, phone, email, boomers, email, text, Gen X, email, text, Facebook, millennials, text, Instagram, Tumblr, Snapchat. Basically, anything that has nothing to do with face-to-face communication, right? They're going to flee from those situations. And then lastly, their attitude when it comes to communication. Builders need background info and details. Boomers want to keep it professional. Gen X need options and zero meetings. And millennials want brevity, real time, and quick responses. And we're going to talk specifically about that last one here in a minute. So we're going to do the same exercise, but we're going to look at work now. Each generation has a different perspective when it comes to work. Builders viewed as a responsibility. Boomers a place, Gen X a means to an end, millennials a vehicle. Their view of it, builders, lifers, boomers are defined by their work. Gen X a tool, millennials fulfilling. They're looking for meaningful work. And then lastly, their attitude, builders, they'll tell you you're lucky to have a job, right? Boomers will tell you loyalty is rewarded. Gen X, work hard, play hard, looking for that work-life balance. And millennials want to work smart. They're going to lean into their high-tech background to, you know, shorten the time frames to get work done faster. And then the last segment we're going to look at here is the leadership. Builders want to endure it, just hanging in there, right? Boomers want to respect it. Gen X want to ignore it. Gen X, very entrepreneurial, coming into the workplace. And then millennials want to choose it. I'm just going to hit pause right there. Millennials grew up in an age of customization. They could customize the shoes they wore, the t-shirts they wore, to the cars they would eventually not drive. And so they pull that into the workplace. They're looking to customize. They want some of that customization in their own hands. And then their view of it, when it comes to leadership, builders want to honor it, boomers respect, Gen X autonomy, millennials equals. If you ask millennials who their best friends are, what would be the top response? I heard it. Yep, parents. It's not Siri or their friends or themselves, right? Their best friend is their parents. So boomers, I think that's noble. You raise a generation that wants to hang out with you. But they pull that now into the workplace. So they look at some of their leaders as equals, and they want to be friends. And that's why you see a lot of the informality emerging as well. And then lastly, when it comes to leadership, and Robin kind of touched on this as well. Builders, no news is good news. Boomers, feedback once per year. Gen X, routine check-ins. And millennials want that constant feedback from their leaders. All right, so I want to give you four elements now. I gave you some really good foundational of what it looks like in the 21st century when it comes to generations, specifically millennials. So I'm going to give you some actionable tips to move forward with. And in each one of these segments, I'm going to give you some context. I'm going to give you a stat. I'm going to give you some examples, and I'll give you a tip. And the first element that will engage millennials is innovation. 78% of millennials were strongly influenced by how innovative a company was when deciding if they wanted to work there. And secondly, 66% of millennials work in organizations that actively encourage/reward its people for innovative ideas. They're looking for innovation. So a couple examples of who's doing this well, LinkedIn. LinkedIn has and by the way, a lot of this is perhaps outside of some of the industries that you're all associated with, and that's on purpose, right? If I told you stuff that a lot of your competitors were doing, you just become copycats, right? So this stuff's gonna be hopefully different and outside your space to really get the gears turning. But what does LinkedIn do? They have a program where any employee in the organization can submit an idea. That could be an idea about a new product or service, about a new system or process, and they do that every quarter, and every quarter they choose a few ideas, and whoever submitted those ideas then gets the power, I guess the authority, to go execute those ideas. They get to cut red tape and try to figure out how to do the idea. So it's a great, strong example of how innovation and how they're leveraging an organization where ideas truly can now come from anywhere. The second example is a company called ADP, Automatic Data Processing. I heard a VP talk about this specific story on a stage from a change management conference. So brilliant, it's a great fit for what we talk about here. They are a comprehensive payroll service company. They were started in, I believe, 1949, they have 60,000 employees. They've always been considered a conservative company. But they knew, okay, we live in exponential times. How do we reinvigorate our company? How do we, if we were to rebuild our organization today in 2016, in exponential times, in the digital age that we live in, what would our business look like? So they started what they call an innovation lab 15 miles from their headquarters. And they began to staff it differently. They began hiring millennials. They began changing the physical workspace and how people work and collaborate. And they began to just rethink everything, the processes, systems they use. And if you asked ADP if it was a success, they would tell you with a resounding yes. Why? Because it's created more open collaboration. It's fostered more creativity. And most importantly for ADP is they're able now to come to market faster with new products and services. So they're now leveraging what they created in that innovation lab, and they're trying to have that become the culture throughout the entire organization. So my strategy, my tip here when it comes to innovation is to infuse entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship is this idea of acting like an entrepreneur within a larger organization, right? We saw that millennials want to be entrepreneurs. They like that idea. So how can you leverage them inside your organization to perhaps execute on new projects or rethink how things have always been done? And the bottom line here is the permission and power to innovate will engage millennials. Number two is flexibility. 73% of millennials expect to be able to modify and customize their work computer, and get this, 63% will go around IT to find the solutions they need. So if you don't give it to them, they're gonna find ways to do it. They are a resourceful bunch. Millennial Mike had access to Google in high school, remember. 69% of millennials believe office attendance is unnecessary on a regular basis. Many of my audiences say that's low. They think that's really low. Perhaps it is. So we're talking about flexibility. So a couple of good examples here. Number one is Deloitte. Deloitte has a program that they call, it's called the Mass Career Customization. And they allow their new hires to basically choose the work that they do. I like to think of it as a choose your own adventure book. Remember those? It's a choose your own adventure book when it comes to how, where, when, and what you work on. So powerful example on how to engage this generation when it comes to flexibility. PricewaterhouseCoopers, this year, 2016, they are going to launch what they call the Loan Paydown Program. Millennials have the largest student debt of any generation. Chris told us that might not be as alarming as we thought, but they still have a lot of debt compared to any other generation. And so PricewaterhouseCoopers is leaning into that, and they're going to offer employees that have been with the company between 1 to 7 years, which is about 50% of their organization, and they're going to offer them $1,200 every year to contribute towards their debt. So it's a good, strong example of how they're leveraging flexibility. They're trying to rethink some of their existing benefits, compensation, whatever it may be, to engage this generation. So my example here is to embrace output versus input. Let me kind of set the stage on this a little bit. Raise your hand if you've ever checked your work email in bed in the morning or evening outside of work. Raise your hand. That's probably 80% of the room. How many of you have ever checked email on vacation? That seems like everyone. You all are troubled people. Might have to have a workaholic session next year or something. So we just proved what I'm about to go into, and that work doesn't have to happen in a place anymore. Work has shifted from a place to a space. From a place to a space. It wasn't too long ago that you had to get into a car and drive to a building, and inside that building is where work happened, right? And then you left and you went home and you didn't have the capacity to work anymore. Wouldn't that have been nice today? So no longer does work happen in a place, and Robin alluded to this as well. But we can't, if we all buy into that, and I think we all just proved it, we can't manage based on input, based on butts in seats, time at desks, the input of time or tenure, if you will. It's inefficient to manage via input. We have to manage on output, the results, the outcome. And so as leaders, here's the bottom line, we've got to provide clear results-driven direction to engage millennials. If they know exactly what's expected of them, then let them choose, right, to how they would get that work done, whether that be the tools or the time that it takes to do that. And in certain regards, you have to have a firm time frame, right, in some industries and for some organizations, so that's understandable. But if that's the case, communicate the why. You need to communicate to them why this has to be done at a certain time. All right, number three is feedback. This is there's managers pulling out their hair every day across the country when it comes to feedback and delivering it to millennials. 42% of millennials want feedback every week, and that's twice the percentage of every other generation. And 50% is how much more often millennials want feedback over other employees. Remember Millennial Mike? Gaming, it created a constant feedback loop, so he's craving that feedback. So a couple examples. One is a company called Bunny Inc. They've got about 50 employees. They're an online professional services company. And they deliver employee surveys via a tool called Niko Niko, N-I-K-O, Niko Niko. And it mirrors a lot of millennial social behaviors, whether that be swiping left for no or right to yes, or using a mobile device to say, you know, out of 1 out of 10, how satisfied are you with the company, with leadership, with the cleanliness of the workspace? And so they've seen tremendous results in how engaged and how much surveys they get back internally from their employees using this new tool. So it's a strong example in how we can leverage technology and mirror some of the social behaviors of millennials to get more feedback. And that's kind of an internal example. The next example is Charity Water. Charity Water delivers clean water to places around the world that need it. And what Clarity Water does is they actually communicate internally via Slack. Remember that app that I told you about earlier? That's one of the fastest growing tech companies we've seen in a while. They communicate via Slack. So no longer do they use email. It's all using Slack. And millennials are flocking to it because, again, we're thinking about feedback here, is that no longer does a millennial have to sit down and send an email to their manager and then hope, cross their fingers and wait till they get a response or feedback on that project. They can now use Slack and post the feedback they're looking for or the help that they need. And then peers, colleagues, other managers can chime in, give them the feedback they need, and then they're able to be that much more productive. So it's making organizations more productive, and it's very native for millennials. So powerful, powerful tool. And the last example here, probably the most groundbreaking, is GE. Just recently, last year, GE announced that they're going to do away with their 30-year-long annual review process. They've scrapped it. And in its place, they've created an app where they can get mobile, fast, and frequent feedback. And if you ask the head of HR why they did that, they tell you they're considering the young professionals, the millennials in their organization, and the need they have for feedback. Hopefully those get the gears turning when it comes to feedback. And my tip here is to practice frequent feedback. I think if we're honest with ourselves and we think about feedback, we kind of get a cold chill down our spine, right? Feedback is normally semi-annually, annually, scheduled time, one-on-one, checking boxes. It's not a good experience for both parties. But we now live in an age where feedback can happen on the fly. It can happen in real time. you know, Slack is a good example. I recently worked with a gentleman. I taught this, and he came up to me after the presentation and said, "Hey, I'm using, you know, this. Can I tell you how I'm doing?" I said, "Sure, absolutely." He said, "I've got a young team of millennials, and at the end of each day, before I turn on my car, I sit in my car and I'll text my millennials. I'll give them correction or direction, not fluffy praise or random, you know, participation ribbons via emojis. That's not what he does. Correction or direction." And he said, "Ryan, every time I do that, I'm always shocked at the end of the day how many millennials are back online and they're executing against that correction or feedback I gave them." So I think we have a dated view when it comes to feedback. So I think we need to take a step back, reevaluate it, and how can you start delivering feedback, one, to satisfy this need for millennials, but two, to make them more productive. So the bottom line here is to favor frequent feedback to engage millennials. And then the last strategy I want to talk about is development. The number one reason millennials leave an organization is the lack of career opportunity. And 71% of millennials likely to leave a company within 2 years believe their leadership skills are not being fully developed. So a couple examples of who's doing development well. Babson College has what they call the reversing the classroom. It's not quite a reversing the classroom, but every few weeks, every semester, they allow the students to teach the class. They allow the students to, they understand that the students have a certain skill set, certain knowledge base that a professor might not have, so they're allowing the students to teach the class things on, you know, how to build an app or the state of the food truck industry, something relevant that the millennials might be interested in. So it gives those millennials teaching the class great development opportunities about communication skills, research. And then it equips the audience with a new set of perhaps relevant information that they could use to further their development. And then the other example is Zappos, our favorite shoe retailer, right? They actually do two things really well. Number one, they have they offer all of the relevant mentorship and training needed for any employee across the country or across their organization to move into a senior manager role within 5 to 7 years. Now you think 5 to 7 years, that seems like an eternity for millennials, and yes, you're probably right. But what they do is they actually incentivize them every 6 months. They give them opportunities to learn new skills, and if they do that, they can level up, get certified in a certain skill set, and they receive an automatic pay bump, or they might actually move into a different title or role. And so they're incentivizing them all along the way to keep them engaged, to keep them developing, and it's a tremendous value add for their employees and for Zappos as well. All right, so the last strategy I'm going to tell you about is reverse mentoring. How many of you say or know have heard about reverse mentoring? A few of you, okay. It's exactly what it sounds like. It's when you find someone that's more junior than you and you ask them to mentor you. It really kind of got its start with Jack Welch at GE. He found so much benefit in this reverse mentoring role, he mandated that 500 of the folks on his team begin engaging in reverse mentoring. And it's so popular now that HP, Cisco, GE, Coca-Cola have structured reverse mentoring programs. And here's why it works. Millennials have been reverse mentoring from a very early age. They were the household CTO, right? They were helping mom and dad to figure out what Facebook was and how to use their mobile device or a computer. So they're very skilled, it's very natural for them to engage in this type of relationship. But I want to urge you, I want to stress you, if you want to engage in this, go beyond technology or social media and ask a millennial to teach you about leadership. I think you'll get all kinds of perspective. Of course, you know, you've got more experience in that regard, but I think you'll learn a lot about what they appreciate leadership is. And the last thing I think too, what makes it really powerful, this reverse mentoring, is that by default, you are modeling what it looks like to have strong communication skills. And that is something that this generation desperately needs. So you can model what a firm handshake looks like, what eyeball to eyeball, face-to-face communication looks like, the value of learning from other people. So I think that's truly the bonus here, right? The hidden gem in this. And so bottom line, it creates opportunities for millennials to develop their communication skills. So something to consider. All right, as we kind of wrap these up, I want to give you a quick example of someone, a leader, that's doing this very well. This comes from Jim Tomsula. We got any 49ers fans in the house? Boo, no one. So Jim Tomsula, this is not an example of how to take a team to the Super Bowl or how to not get fired as an NFL coach, okay? This is not that example. But it's a good example. It'll get the gears turning to how they're leveraging this. So Jim Tomsula, he was the head coach of the 49ers last year, and he was asked at the beginning of the season, what do you think about social media? He said, I hate it, I don't get it, I don't understand it. You know, why bother? It didn't take Jim very long to change his tune because when you have an average age of a team of 25.2 years old, you need to understand social media. This is how they communicate. So he began to say, okay, I need to evolve my leadership if I'm going to engage with these millennials. So here's what he did. Number one, he used innovation. They switched to digital reminders. They used to still pin up paper with schedule and reminders on it. They did away with that because every millennial has a mobile device, so they've gone with digital reminders. Number two, flexibility. They went to shorter meetings. They used to have 2-hour meetings. You can't hold a millennial's attention for 2 hours. So they cut that to 30 minutes. They're using more interactivity and visuals in their meetings. And then lastly, he's using development. He's using reverse mentoring. Jim had a standing meeting with players, and he would have them teach them about technology and what they were thinking about career-wise and leadership. It was a standing meeting. So a great example of how, yes, we need to start rethinking our leadership. My message is not we have to change to cater to the millennials. That is not my message. My message is we need to adjust and be adaptive so that we can lead, run our businesses, and communicate like it's 2016. We need to be 21st century ready if we're going to thrive in the future. That's my message. All right, so in the interest of time, no questions, but please email me if you have your questions. I'm going to wrap things up with a quick story on how to effectively manage change. I think you guys will really enjoy. Hopefully, my website is still up at some point. A lot of good stuff on there, but at some point, at the end of the day, I'll have it back up so you guys can go there to get all these slides. And then lastly, for those that want extra credit, jot this down as well. I'm a millennial, so I'm looking for some feedback here, okay? So if you go to this link, ryan-jenkins.com/survey, there will be a survey there, easy, 7 questions, just interested in some of your feedback. And if you do that as a bonus, one of the questions I always get after these sessions is, how do we start building or training millennials to be effective and ready 21st century leaders? They still have a lot, long ways to go when it comes to communications. How do you stamp out or overcome the sense of entitlement? Those are stuff that we're working on to try to help organizations. So more to come on that. But a good starting point, and we'll send it if you do the survey, is our latest book, which is 18 Next Generation Statistics to help shape your millennial training and future-proof your organization. So as a bonus, we'll get that to you if you complete that survey. I want to wrap up our time with a quick story. I think everything that we talked about today, the underbelly of it all is change. And as humans, we hate change. We resist change. But the funny thing is change is no respecter of person. And no, I'm not checking my Instagram feed. I'm actually going to pull up the story that I'm about to share. Change. So it's always coming. It's always going to hit us. It's like the waves of the ocean. It's constant and relentless. So this story is called Autobiography in 5 Short Chapters by Portia Nelson, and in it are the 5 steps on how you manage change effectively, okay? I think you guys will enjoy this. Chapter 1, I walk down the street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I fall in. I am lost. I am helpless. It isn't my fault. It takes forever to find a way out. Phase 1 of change is ignorance. Chapter 2, I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I pretend I don't see it. I fall in again. I can't believe I'm in the same place, but it isn't my fault. It still takes a long time to get out. Phase 2 of change is self-deception. Chapter 3, I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I see it there. I still fall in. It's a habit, but my eyes are open. I hope after today, your eyes are open. I know where I am. It is my fault. I get out immediately. Phase 3 of change is surrender. Chapter 4, I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I walk around it. Phase 4 of change is adjustment. And finally, chapter 5, I walk down another street. Phase 5 of change is freedom. So after our time today, It's truly, 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 my hope for you is that you find your new street and you choose to walk boldly down it. Thanks for having me.
All right, thank you, sir. Man, that was awesome. Thank you. Ryan, that was awesome. Thank you very much. Would you join me once again thanking Ryan and all of our speakers today? If you haven't done so, please take a minute to fill out your evaluation form, leave it on the table, or give it to the folks in the lobby. One last thing, please take a look at the back of your program. If you find a sticker, you get to take home the centerpiece filled with a lot of goodies from local favorites. And once again, on behalf of the Kern Economic Development Corporation, the Greater Bakersfield Chamber of Commerce, and California State University Bakersfield, thank you for coming. We'll see you next year. Bye-bye, everyone.